happening worldwide on this Wednesday transmission. This is what the TPP means to your future jobs.
On November 5th, 2015, the TPP was finally released to the public. On the very same day, President Obama declared he would sign it. 12 countries participated in negotiations for the TPP. All 12 signed the TPP on February 4th, 2016. The agreement will enter into force after ratification by all signatories, if ratified within 2 years. If the agreement is not ratified by all before February 4th, 2018, it will enter into force after ratification by at least 6 states, which together have a GDP of more than 85% of the GDP of all signatories. For the time being, and fortunately, it's an election year and Obama is a lame duck president. It will be a photo finish for the TPP within the confines of Obama's temporary reign.
Why can't Obama do something that actually helps Americans? Oh, yeah, that's right. He's not really supporting anything to do with America or the Constitution.
That's like for pathetic human scum.
The TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, a so-called trade agreement that basically creates a legalized one-world government, a legal bulwark into the sovereignty of nations, delivering poisonous food shipped right to your local grocery store. And those prescriptions that you desperately needed will now be unaffordable as Big Pharma gets all it ever wished for. And that's just the TPP. There are two other heads to this hydra that we are aware of. The ultra-secretive TISA, or Trade in Services Agreement, intended to be classified for 5 years after being signed. Fortunately for us, key portions of it were exposed by WikiLeaks. TISA essentially clears the way for the multinational corporations to regulate the management of public laws. TISA would also privatize state-owned enterprises. And let's not forget the knockout punch thrown by the TTIP, or the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, essentially forming a more imperfect union between the United States and the European Union. The profound changes on the horizon are why the puppets of the multinational corporations felt it was time to clue future generations in on the wonderful devastation they have in store for their future. Of course, explaining it bluntly isn't what they had in mind. They felt they should sugarcoat the truth with total bullshit.
America is a better place today than it was when I graduated from college. It also happens to be better off than when I took office, but that's a longer story. The point is, you need allies in a democracy. It's not a black or white thing. Go to any country where the give and take of democracy has been repealed by one party rule, and I will show you a country that does not work.
There are no walls big enough to stop people from anywhere, tens of thousands of miles away, who are determined to take their own lives while they target others. So I think that everything that we've lived and learned tells us that we will never come out on top if we accept advice from soundbite salesmen and carnival barkers who pretend the most powerful country on earth can remain great by looking inward and hiding behind walls at a time that technology has made that impossible to do and unwise to even attempt. The future demands from us something more than a nostalgia for some rose-tinted
version
of a past that did not really exist in any case. And I think that everyone here, especially the class of 2016, understands that viscerally, internally, intellectually. You're about to graduate into a complex and borderless world.
Congratulations, class of 2016. Your future of endless financial aid payments, robot replacements, and a multinational screw job to your chosen career, diet, national sovereignty, and healthcare is on the verge of being
set. But they can be transgender, though.
On the fast track to be guaranteed to begin in 2018.
Or trans species.
So are you still convinced that Obama was a great president?
Look how helpless they are.
You all have some work to do. So enjoy the party. Because you're going to be busy.
John Brown, Freakwars.com.
Enjoy the club. You ain't in it. We'll be back, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Alex Jones, your host. We're broadcasting worldwide. We are, of course, mainly a radio transmission on hundreds of affiliates across the United States, global satellite, shortwave, you name it, but also simulcasting on some TV stations, cable stations around the country, and living color streaming full television news production at Infowars.com/show. And I tell you, I'm actually enjoying this broadcast so far because I'm not somebody that likes big, bright lights in my eyes. I used to really love just doing radio in a dark room with a little light shooting down on the table where I could focus in on the news. But I wanted to play videos. I wanted to show photos. I wanted to show documents. Back in 1996, 97, before the internet had become more ubiquitous, more popular, more widespread, it was really expensive to show somebody a video clip or even show an article. You could put a photo up and it might get read a million times, but you'd get a bill for $5,000. Bandwidth was much more expensive. So I began basically trying to develop the technologies and systems or find the technologies and systems to stream video on the internet. And we are, of course, one of the first to do that with radio slash television. It's been duplicated a lot today by Glenn Beck, the Young Turks, and many others. But this is one of the first times I've ever worn sunglasses on air. And that's because I got a piece of sand or glass in my right eye, and then it got infected. It's getting better, but I look like something out of a horror movie right now. So I'm going to be donning the Blues Brothers glasses here today. And I am really enjoying not having as much blaring light in my face. But watch, this will become the big topic. Alex Jones wearing sunglasses instead of all the amazing news we're about to cover. At least with the mainstream media. You know, it's better than an eye patch. I was thinking about an eye patch, but that was a little too much. So we're going to go with the sunglasses here today. Okay, I'm really said this 1,000 times, never really been able to do it, but I'm going to attempt as best I can to cover all the news today because it's so over the top important. Senate kicks off debate over reauthorizing controversial NSA program. No, it's illegal. Also, Senate Commerce Committee launches inquiry into Facebook over trending topics of censorship. And exactly what we told you years ago about Facebook that's been getting worse the last few months has been confirmed. They have algorithms set to block libertarian, conservative, nationalistic, pro-Trump type information, which does show they're trying to create a monopoly of information. It is highly unethical and highly illegal, especially when you don't tell people you're doing it. This whole line about, well, they own the website. Yes, and they hold it out that it's a free open commons of ideas as long as you don't violate the, quote, rules, calling for violence or whatever. Now their rules say if you disagree with someone, they can censor you. That is directly out of North Korea. So we're going to be breaking that down as well. An incredible article on Infowars.com by Joshua Krause. We ought to get Krause on. This is exactly what's happening. This article is over the top important. I should probably cover the entire broadcast just on this today. This is so big. This is everything. The White House plans to make the suburbs less wealthy and white. And you read the quotes, they say they're racist, they're bad, they're too wealthy. We're going to have zoning that basically shuts them down or subsidizes, quote, moving poor and minorities into them. Now, what that really means is we're going to tax you, we're going to control you, and we are going to bring in helpless domesticated groups to create divide and conquer strategies. And then when there is racial tensions that the media is going to hype up, we're going to bring in strong cities, UN policies of social justice warrior slash community organizer operatives to further break down the civilization. Under Agenda 21, you're not allowed to run to the country. And by the way, Hispanics, blacks, everybody's running to the country. And you go out to the country, hill country, you go to a homeschooling event or whatever, there are black families, Hispanic families, Asian families, like a third of them. And everybody's getting along, and everybody doesn't trust the government, and everybody's not taking vaccines, and everybody's trying to get Amish milk, and it's a beautiful thing happening. That homeschooling event's at my house, and it looks like true diversity. But they're cool people, and they all know what's going on. I would not invite a bunch of so-called liberal trendies, black, white, Hispanic, to my house in the country because they literally will look for some reason to call the police on you or say your child has a birthmark, you must have beaten them and get in your face, because that's all they know is running around and identifying people that aren't following the Mao Zedong culture system. This article is so incredible. For leftists, multiculturalism isn't always about flooding a country with millions of immigrants from incompatible cultures, as we've seen in Europe over the past few years. It's also about integrating the cultures that already exist within a nation. As far as they are concerned, a neighborhood that lacks diversity is unacceptable. We must all be equal in all ways, even when it comes to the culture and appearances of our communities. You know, I live outside town, but I also got a small condo in closer to town, closer to my parents, and it took me 3 years, and I could never find any of the new condos they're building that they give tax incentives to build them cheaper to the builders, that had a fence around my condo, little 2.5 bedroom, so it has a little study, 2.5 bedroom on the top, a kitchen and a living room, and a entryway on the bottom, very small. Just so when I stay in town or don't want to have to drive back out into the countryside. And I kept asking all the builders, I said, and by the way, you know, you're building, say, 6 condo buildings here, 5 there. I said, why are there no gates on these? They said, oh, the city won't give you a permit now to have a gate on your condos or apartments. And some of these had like 20 buildings with duplexes. So you're talking 40 buildings, 40 homes. I ended up getting one on a little plot that has 6 duplexes on it, no fence. And the city, and I was told this by the builders, so I went and looked it up. They have, quote, guidelines. And it's like, oh, we want an open community. They want it where there's no security, where you can be robbed. They said, we want a, quote, open neighborhood feeling. This is in South Austin, ladies and gentlemen, with projects a mile away. Because, again, they want to dot those all randomly around. And, of course, there's robberies in the areas and rape and all the rest of it. But you haven't got my guns yet, you bastards. But that's just how they work. And now, Agenda 21, we've been to the meetings, we've covered it, we've done the reports, you've seen them here. We ought to edit some of those back together, you know, just composite a bunch of the old reports together. When I say it, they go, oh, you mean cover it up? No, I mean, you know, take like hours of reports and edit them down to maybe a 30-minute report of Agenda 21 meetings where they make people come into the town hall, and all these small towns around Austin that are exploding, and they go, oh, we'll give you tax exemption if you live in this 10-story condo building that even has a factory in the bottom of it, but no one else gets the exemptions. But if you sign on with us, you do. And then they just double the taxes on everybody else, the farmers and ranchers that have been there for 4 generations, and ship in a bunch of people in 300 square foot. They're 300 square foot out in Elgin. In Austin, they're 250. Remember, that's the new liberal way. You get a 250 square foot deal. It cost $2,500 a month. Suddenly, the 1,000 square foot's 5,000 when it was 2.5 a year ago. It's how they scam you. They bring in all these coffin buildings to undercut everything, build up the numbers so then everything skyrockets in price. All these big fat cats and multinationals, foreign governments own some of the buildings downtown. One of them, what is it? The Action, I was reading the paper, is owned by the Dominican Republic. So it's just going to the city governments, make laws to screw everyone, ship in unskilled laborers, third world populations in the middle of small towns, have taxpayers build 10-story buildings in towns where the people in the town are like 2,000. It takes over, then multinationals move in, displace everything, and get lower tax rates. And don't worry, though, they call it not being racist. Just like you don't like Obamacare, you're racist. You don't turn your guns in, you're racist. The new KKK is the NRA. Remember that line when the NRA was founded, the counter of the KKK in part, and to train Northerners how to shoot? I mean, that's a fact. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. UKIP opposes the EU. The British government calls them Nazis, even though the EU plan was set up by the Nazis. Because the public doesn't know their butt from a hole in the ground. And the general public wants freebies. And the general public thinks backstabbing each other and not caring about anybody is how you get ahead. Everybody, especially women now, think it's cool to be hard and cynical and try to get an angle up on you and screw their bosses over. It's just epidemic in the different trade publications I read. But men do it too. And it's all just a entitled, dumbed-down TV generation trained to fall against 21st century technology and scientific cultural takeovers. In the future, one thing is going to trump it all, and that's going to be relationships with people you can trust and that people you're committed to. The most valuable thing is people you can trust and people you're committed to. That's why we're trained to be alone, to not be committed, to not care about anybody, to not care about our kids if we happen to have them, but that's how you get ahead, so everybody's totally alone and totally pathetic. So I'm going to get more into that article. And it goes on to say the federal government, which is multinational, run by UNESCO, is going to come in with small area fair market rents. And they're going to come in with the subsidized government housing and plop them all out in the middle of nowhere. And then they've got the New Freedom initiatives to drug everybody. And then they've got the Rural Affairs Committee set up by Obama with the Department of Defense and the CIA over it to put CIA in every small town to run the op. All right, let's get back on the news. I'm going to cover this more later, but when you read a headline like White House plans to make the suburbs less wealthy and white, that's just always the cover to screw everybody over, like Obamacare. The headline should be globalists to wage war on more independent rural communities not under globalist control. Domestication consolidation program accelerates, similar to programs carried out in Asia, Latin America, and Africa. I remember back in the 1980s, my dad was so excited. He said, they're opening up Mexico to buy land for the first time since Mexico was founded in the 1820s. He's like, it's incredible. And he goes, I want to buy land. So we go down to Cancun, where he'd been before, my first time. We drove to all these spots, and there were UN signs and biosphere. And my dad spoke decent Spanish. And he was talking to locals, and I remember after his second trip down there, he goes, it's a big UN scam. They're forcing all the locals off their property, the Mayans, because they've been there so long. They don't even have deeds to the property. And they're not going to let them fish anymore, and they're going to force them all up into the big cities. And my dad, of course, knew everything back then, and I'm hearing all this. And then later I went and looked it up. That's why Mexico City was like 10 million people in the 80s. It's 35 million now. They just come with machine guns and force you off the land. The only people that haven't been forced off their land in Mexico are the people in Chiapas, because they're just willing to fight to the death. And that's even though they're communist, we buy coffee from them. The communists are the only ones that backed them. They've got that ideology. But really, they're just on the land. They have communes where they grow their own coffee and share the profits. That's just humans working together. Because communism will work at a local, tribal level. Because you still got your house. You still got your wife, your kids, your daughters, your sons, your husband, your grandmother, your grandfather, your family, your cemetery. You've been there. You've got communes where you go dump your food in there, and they kind of look at how much you dumped in, and that's the share you get. That's truly communal sharing. And they grow coffee together, and they kill federales together, and that's a good example because the globalists can't come in and kick them out. Right there on the border with Guatemala. And that's where Wake Up America coffee comes from. I'm not plugging it, but I think it's the best coffee, and then I found out the background of it and got my own sources down there, but I really like it. This is what it's all about. And they're coming in to force you off your land. They're coming in to shut down. Why are there wars on lemonade stands? Why are there wars on swap meets and the Amish? Forbes magazine asked the questions. The Associated Press says, why are there federal task forces out trying to shut down people that don't have permits at Christmas holiday events selling mistletoe? Because they don't want humans used to going and having their own barter and their own systems, because even if the globalists take over, if a handful of people have seeds, and a handful of people know how to do machine work, and a handful of people know how to weave, and if a handful of people know how to farm, and if a handful of people know how to manufacture, it's game over. We can instantly start over during a depression. They're not going to let that happen. During this depression, they're going to ban cash. It'll still be cash, but it'll be digital. I told you 10 years ago or 15 years ago. That's now been announced. I can just see where the enemy's going. And they're getting ready to launch on every front. I don't know if it's this year, next year, or whenever, but it's serious. And it's all engineered. And I've got the news right here. Retail stocks are getting mauled. What gives? Forbes. What gives? There's no container ships going back and forth in the Atlantic, only a few in the Pacific. We are in cardiac arrest by design. Recession may loom for next U.S. president, no matter who it is. Bloomberg. They're just going to admit we're in a depression, basically. We're already in it. Macy's slashes outlook as sales continue to fall. Yeah, I was buying a bed comforter a few weeks ago because one got old. The dog was chewing holes in it. And there was no one there at Macy's. I had to look around for 20 minutes to buy a comforter top. I'd take it downstairs and buy it. Staples, Office Depot shares plunge after merger blocked. And it goes on and on from there. We're going to break that down. So Senate Commerce Committee launches inquiry into Facebook over trending topic censorship. That is so huge. Billy Corgan has been sending me text messages pointing out that this is just giant. We've got to force this issue. That's what he was here pushing a month ago. Notice now Drudge has been covering it big for the last week, and that forced it over the edge. And now the massive censorship and controls being looked at. Again, Senate kicks off debate over reauthorizing controversial NSA spying. We'll get into the latest primary with Sanders winning West Virginia. And also winning some other states. We're going to look at justice's reputation hangs in the balance of Clinton probe. We're going to look at measles outbreak in Memphis began at a mosque. We're also going to get into the latest terror threat news. And I'll tell you about all the big guests coming up, including a new interview never before seen with Billy Corgan on this issue. I'm going to play a whole bunch of special reports and key clips here in a moment, including a very powerful one that deserves to go mega viral. It's only about 3.5 minutes long that Paul Watson shot yesterday. I was listening to the show yesterday, but I wasn't watching. And when he was talking about the guy that made a joke video about Hitler and the pug dog. And it's clearly not pro-Hitler, but even if it was pro-Hitler, you shouldn't get arrested in Scotland. I mean, where's the free speech under the Magna Carta? But he did get arrested, and they're prosecuting him. And then Paul plays two different clips of John Cleese making fun of Hitler. This is a war on culture, folks, and a war on ideas, and they know what they're doing. People keep saying, oh, these are out-of-control idiots. They just don't know what they're doing. It's globally coordinated by the central banks on record. They've got it phased out in a complete plan. You just joined us. I got a piece of glass or something in my eye 2 days ago, and it cut it up, and it's really hurts in the light. So I'm wearing sunglasses, not trying to act cool. Though these are really cool sunglasses. I bought these in Italy, and I tell you, they don't even have these in the U.S., and they are just awesome. The Italians just know how to make sunglasses, shoes, coats, cars. You name it. And the women aren't half bad looking either. Anyways, I like Italians, what's left of them. Okay, let's just continue here going through the news. Before I plunge into that, we got a limited run batch of it. It sold out in a week and a half. We have gotten more of it in. We could have just put out hundreds of different formulas, private labeled, of different vitamin, mineral, multivitamin juices. There's a lot of good ones out there. I promote Beyond Tangy Tangerine. You buy it from us. We get some of the profit, helps fund the operation. It's excellent at InfoWarsHealth.com, along with 400 other great items. But we've got 18 items now that we produce, and I'm very, very proud. This is plant-derived, the full spectrum of minerals and vitamins, and it's concentrated. And it's less than most of the leading competitors out there. It's vitamin mineral fusion, and it's fruit punch flavor. I'm very, very proud of it. Even the different nutraceutical Nazis, and I don't mean that in a bad sense, the Seinfeld sense, you know, the folks that really want the highest quality, like the soup Nazi, the vitamin Nazis out there are really proud of our work. That's why on big third-party sites it gets such incredible reviews. Vitamin Mineral Fusion is loaded with a full month supply of essential vitamins in each canister, minerals, and amino acids that your body needs. This formula is the platinum standard of multivitamin products. The best part is ingredients of Vitamin Mineral Fusion are plant-derived, and the few that aren't are from the highest quality lab standard tested. Just some of the ingredients in Vitamin Mineral Fusion include vitamin C, vitamin E, zinc, magnesium, selenium, L, glutamine, alpha, lipoic acid, folic acid, calcium, and many others. Got a bunch of amino acids, all the minerals, you name it. Visit InfoWarsLife.com and get your bottle of Vitamin Mineral Fusion today before we sell out again of this limited run. That's InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And we have a $10 savings, a 16.68% savings on it. It has a 4.4-star review. And if you sign up for AutoShip, you get 10% off. Additionally, all orders above $50 or more get free shipping on top of that. There are a lot of specials running. Be sure and check those out. But let's say you're addicted to soft drinks. Let's say you are your kids love, you know, drinking too much orange juice, which has some good stuff in it for you, but incredible sugar. This has fractions of that. It's naturally flavored with xylitol. And it's just, it even hardly has any of that because the stuff in it just naturally tastes so good. It's like vitamin B12 just tastes good in and of itself. It tastes like sugar. There's no sugar in it. And what I do is I take like a Topo Chico that's really good in my view, Mexican naturally carbonated water. And I put that in and then I stir up like a quarter scoop. It's so strong. I put ice in it. And it's the best fruit punch ever. And it tastes just as good as a soda pop, to use the Yankee term, carbonated fruit drink. I mean, I like Coca-Cola. I like Pepsi. I can't drink it. It's got, you know, baby flavoring in the Pepsi and the Coca-Cola and all the rest of it is just so incredibly toxic. The evidence is overwhelming. Full of heavy metals, you name it, for whatever reason. This stuff is all tested California-level standard, and it just is so delicious. I'll put it up against the best soft drink any day. Because, yeah, soft drinks are bad for you. They taste incredibly delicious. Let's not lie about it. Well, we took us 2 years to develop this. I'm very proud of it. No artificial flavors, so it's not bright red. It's orangish pink, and it's just amazing. My kids love it. They get their multivitamin right here, and it's so much more absorbable because it's being done as a liquid going through the digestive process, starting in the mouth with the saliva that begins to absorb it, adds the key cofactors, the key acids to break it down. It then goes into the stomach. It's got the amino acids, all of it in there, and just does amazing things. So I'm done plugging. But Vitamin Mineral Fusion is available back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. Get all the great longevity products like Beyond Tangy Tangerine. That it's like saying, what do you like better, you know, a Sprite or a 7-Up? I like them both. This is like a 7-Up, and then the Beyond Tangy Tangerine is like a Sprite. I mean, they're both delicious. They're both good for you. I sell both. I sell theirs, and I sell mine. And just, you know, people differ on what they like better. I think they all go to, this is plant-derived. Theirs is Deep Earth provided. It's just all a good mix for folks. So InfoWarsHealth.com for Beyond Tangy Tangerine, InfoWarsLife.com for Vitamin Mineral Fusion. Okay, let's now just one more thing. We had to end the big special on food because the competitors were getting upset. I mean, they distribute one of the biggest outfits in the country, My Patriot, super high quality. We sell all their products, but they have a lot of other distributors, a lot of other sellers, other private labelers, and they just don't like how low I go. And I said, can I please do it a few more days? They said, we told you no, please stop. I said, what about if I take the four best sellers we've got and just offer those at 40% off for one more week? They called me back. They said, yes, one more week, but that's it. We already had the lowest prices. You don't need to go this low. And I understand that, but I like to do this. I like to dominate. I like a win-win. I like to have loss leaders. This isn't quite a loss leader. We make some profit, and it helps fund the operation. So get your storable foods now. I think you're crazy if you don't. InfoWarsStore.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. Separately, I got some sand or something swimming in the creek Monday night. Anthony came over. He swam with myself and the kids. We went around chasing fireflies in the dusk. And then he went home after dinner. But I was swimming around, and I got some sand in my eye, and it kind of cut my eye. And my dad looked at it in the morning, and, you know, he's a dentist, but he still knows his medical stuff. So he says, yeah, you got serration. You're cutting there. But then by yesterday, it got infected. And I never hardly get infected, but it got all bright red and stuff. To the point I couldn't even open my eye yesterday. Now it's still red, about half as red, but I can open my eye, and I'll tell you if it works. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. That's why you got to have a mix of mainline medicine and colloidal silver. But it's already getting a lot better since I started putting it in yesterday. And I'm going to put some colloidal silver in my eye right now. And it's one of the known powerful antibiotics out there when other stuff doesn't work. And again, it's starting to help, but by tomorrow, if it isn't 100% better, I'm going to go ahead and get the eye drops there that are so toxic but actually work. So colloidal silver in the eye, and we will see how it works. I've done this with other infections over the last decade. I don't know, 4 or 5 times on air. 3 times it worked. 1 time it didn't. And the antibiotics had to do it. It's when I bumped into the Supreme Court building. This guard jumps out and goes, "What are you doing?" So I was videotaping up by the front door. It was on a Sunday. And I turned towards the big foot of the pillar. It was so high, it was up to my shin. Cut through my jeans, cut the front of my leg. And then about a month later, pus started just gushing out of it. I don't want to get graphic here, but you know, infectious disease, one of the biggest killers, the bacteria becoming immune, the viruses are becoming immune-resistant. Colloidal silver, iodine, natural herbs. By the time I went to the doctor and they x-rayed, it was rotted all the way down to my shin, all the way down to my foot inside. And within 24 hours of big injections of antibiotics, boom, it stopped. How magic. So I'm not bashing MD medicine, but it's like a nuclear option. The colloidal silver I was kind of putting into the wound didn't help, because I guess it had already gotten so deep down. But other times when antibiotics didn't work, with the chest colds and stuff that killed members of my family, remember 2 years ago, colloidal silver did. My dad was in bed for a month. Antibiotics weren't working. Third round, I dumped 3 bottles of colloidal silver down his throat, 30 parts per million, and it knocked it out in a matter of days. Amazing, at least from my experience. InfoWarsLife.com, Silver Bullet is there as well, and you're crazy if you don't get prepared. All right, I'm going to stop plugging. Please support our local AM&F affiliates. Become a sponsor. Support the local sponsors. It is so essential. It is so important. I'll do a shorter plug next hour, but I wanted to get that in right there. Okay, where to begin? Where should we start? There is so much to go over here. I already mentioned some of this, but I want to drill back into some of the articles we haven't hit yet. Shock, 50% of Bernie voters pick Trump over Hillary. Incredible article by Kit Daniels. Needs to go so viral. If Hillary steals nomination, Trump gains Bernie votes. Half of Bernie Sanders supporters would vote for Donald Trump over Hillary Clinton, a Fox News exit poll in West Virginia revealed. Now, that is the coal miner area, but it's still 20, 30% in other areas we've seen. He's getting 20%, 25% with the black Americans who normally go 10% Republican. I mean, folks get that he's populist. In fact, in some cases, he's too liberal, folks. It's not that he's too extreme or racist in my issue. But that's a Big Ten approach. Sanders won West Virginia with around 124,000 votes compared to Clinton's 86,000, meaning that approximately 72% of those votes Clinton received in the primary, half of Sanders represent the Democrats who would vote for Trump. Trump's chances against Clinton may be better than anyone thought, Fox News admitted. Well, CNN was in coal country in West Virginia and couldn't find one person out of 20 in a Democrat event who weren't going to vote for Trump. And if he gets that same nationalist message out to everybody else that actually wants to work and can work, to quote Merle Haggard, "But a man can still work, still would," then it's game over for Herr Hitlery. Speaking of Herr Hitlery, I'm going to air this since I mentioned it right now. It's only a few minutes long. The video's up on InfoWars.com, but I want to tweet it out again and post it on Facebook again, because make fun of Hitler, you will be arrested. I mean, that's really what the headline should be. Paul's headline was pretty good, you know. Make fun of Hitler on YouTube, get arrested. But it's really just make fun of Hitler, get arrested. Comedy is now illegal. Charlie Chaplin made fun of Hitler. I've made fun of Hitler. Remember, Jesse James made fun of Hitler, and they said, "Oh, you're a Nazi." This is an assault on reality. How dare people tell Americans and Scots and folks that died in mass fighting Hitler, our grandparents, that we're with Hitler if some liberal trendy who's apologized, and turns out he's a liberal, of course he apologized, shouldn't apologize, should say, "I didn't do anything, it's satire, it's protected." But by him groveling, they keep charging him. He should say, "How dare you," and get a jury trial. This is happening everywhere. We'll put the headline back up on screen. I want to put it on Facebook. I want to retweet it. Police now arresting YouTubers for offensive videos. No speeches safe, folks. I've got a stack of news. A teacher in Germany, a teacher in Austria, there's two different stories today, one in Germany, one in Austria. The teacher in Austria talked about the Quran, talking about Muhammad saying you can have sex with 12-year-olds, and said that's pedophilia, and she's been arrested. Now, folks, separately, China's been caught shipping in little girls for sex slaves, and they're calling it sex slavery. It is what it is. But this, even if it wasn't true that Muhammad said that, wrote that. You should have a right to say it. This is tyranny. Teacher to be prosecuted for calling Muhammad a child molester. The middle school teacher in the Austrian city is facing criminal prosecution for her comments regarding the founder of Islam. And they've got Turkish people that make fun of Erdogan on TV in Germany being arrested. This is the left is evil. They're not the left. They're a group of criminals coming to take over, and they mean business. And they've got every lazy nobody brown shirt joining in on a power trip thinking they're about to get the spoils. The spoils disappear very quick, dummies. Look at Venezuela. Let's go ahead and go to this incredible report by Paul Joseph Watson.
28-year-old Marcus Meacham was arrested for hate crimes after posting this joke video of his girlfriend's dog reacting to Nazi slogans.
My girlfriend is always ranting raving about how cute and adorable her wee dog is. And so I thought I would turn him into the least cute thing that I could think of, which is a Nazi. Buddha, do I gas the Jews? Gas the Jews? Jews.
See, Kyle.
Jews.
The video went viral, receiving 18,000 thumbs up to just 1,200 thumbs down. The vast majority of viewers thought that it was hilarious, but thanks to a small minority of perpetually offended retards, Meacham got a home visit from the Scottish police. Authorities said that Meacham's arrest is a lesson to others that any video content deemed offensive will not be tolerated. Meacham then prostrated himself, pleading that he wasn't a racist and that he only made the video to annoy his girlfriend. Isn't it interesting that John Cleese recently came out and decried political correctness? Because under that definition, Cleese himself would have been arrested for this Fawlty Towers sketch.
Who's this then? Stop you, my no!
He would have also been hit with hate crimes charges for this Monty Python sketch.
I am not a racist, but Monty is a racist.
Charlie Chaplin would have been thrown in a jail cell for the same reason. If they're now treating any video content whatsoever that causes offense as hate speech, then my entire channel is hate speech. It's getting close to where I'm going to have to leave the country simply to continue to make YouTube videos. They're already arresting people who criticize Muslim immigration on Twitter. Now satire, frigging satire that's not even malicious, will not be tolerated. And this is by no means a one-off case. Just a few days ago, a Muslim police chief in Manchester said, freedom of speech does not mean freedom of offending culture, religion, or tradition. Just last month, Greater Glasgow police threatened to conduct home visits to harass people who made unkind or inaccurate tweets. Last year, Police Scotland announced their intention to investigate offensive comments made on Twitter and other social media platforms. Of course, this is all selectively enforced, but the chilling effect is very real. This is how political correctness is strangling freedom. People are going to be terrified of expressing any political belief, even if it's satirical, even if it's not even meant to be political, if we allow them to characterize Nazi jokes or Muhammad cartoons as hate speech. Then it's only the beginning. The end will bring us full circle to the very reason political correctness was created in communist countries in the first place. To stifle, censor, and punish anyone who dares speak out against the state or the prevailing cultural mantra.
Great job, Paul Watson. I'm going to take that little short video and just add a few other clips to it. With the analysis I'm doing here as a larger video, what about all the Disney cartoons making fun of Hitler? If this Nazi land so great, we wouldn't leave it if we could. You know, and just all the rest of the mindlessness. But what if you want to be pro-Nazi? You're allowed to do that in Europe. You're allowed to do that here in the U.S., but not anymore. Now making fun of it isn't allowed. And people go into JCPenney and they see a silver teapot, which, by the way, is a really nice teapot. And they think because there's a round handle that looks a little like a mustache and the handle could be hair. That's like seeing Hitler in a cloud. They want it banned. And guess what? JCPenney did ban it. They did ban it. And now it goes for a premium. And now they're saying, don't wear, you know, black jackets. That could be a Nazi. This is the type of stuff that's going on, ladies and gentlemen. And now they're saying, don't say I want Mexican or Chinese food, because saying that the name could be hurtful. All knowledge is hurtful. By the way, during the video, I remembered, it was 4 or 5 years ago, I did a video called Hitler Dog with my French bulldog, still living. He's old now. Captain. And we made a joke about how since they're afraid of the teapot, that was in 2013, I guess three, four years ago, that I made the joke that, oh, no, now we've got Hitler Dog. Perhaps we should play part of Hitler Dog. And then it gets worse. I mean, there's all these other cartoons and movies and people making fun of Hitler. But see, it's only selectively enforced. Look, there's Donald Duck as a Nazi. Arrest him. If this Nazi lands so good, we would leave it if we could. All Heil Hitler, New World Order. That's a quote. They'll probably have New York Times say, Jones said Heil Hitler on air, preying on their audience, thinking you're dumb. Obamacare is free. I have clips here with National News making fun of their dumb viewers, going, we told them they could keep their doctor. It's like Grouper up there at a big university. I teach people how to lie, and my lies are best. They're like, oh, and the public's so dumb, we're ripping them off. This is how sick these people are. In fact, do we have Hitler Dog ready? Can we just play it right off YouTube? Ladies and gentlemen, I may be arrested if I ever travel to Scotland. And don't forget, Michael Savage and hundreds of others are now banned from going to the UK because they criticize radical Islam. And the communist Chinese went and funded U.S. groups to blackball his book about China being a threat. That's how much control there is in this country. And we've had to deal with it and been threatened over talking about the House of Saud. We get told, leave them alone. If you want to be on these stations, this is already going on. This is already happening in America. And it gets worse, ladies and gentlemen. It gets worse. This totalitarianism. The good news is it's becoming so blatant. These attempts to bully people that are literally authoritarian, literally Nazi-like, what the so-called left is doing. This is a very important from the International Business Times. Senate Commerce Committee launches inquiry into Facebook over trending topics censorship. Isn't that just special? So the good news is they tried to act like for the last few months where Drudge made a big deal out of this. We made a big deal out of this. International Frontier Foundation, the different internet groups made a big deal out of it. They went, oh, it's their website. They're allowed to do it. And their own employees started coming out saying, no, we completely block anything patriotic, anything pro-Trump, anything pro-gun, anything pro-Benghazi investigation, anything anti-Hillary. Mainline news is censored. You in America, on your supposed Facebook, where you and your friends share ideas, they don't let you share that info. They don't let people share videos that we post on Facebook. Now, the first few months, they weren't blocking us. But when the videos all started getting about 1 million views on average, some got 4 million views. Why in the market of ideas? We were winning. Can't have that. Can't have that. We had a Charlie Daniels video up there with 1.5 million views in a week. Oh, someone else made a copyright claim, even though we had the authorization. That's just how all of this works to shut things down. Do we have Hitler Dog, guys? We're having a problem downloading. It doesn't matter. There's no need to fear. Hitler Dog is here. Oh, dear. Astronium 12 detonator. I'll have to destroy the Earth. That pesky Earth creature. Oh, dear. The fluoride didn't work on this one. He's fighting back against my takeover. Hurry, chemtrail him immediately. I will have the technological developments for myself. This planet, I declare for Bill Gates. See, if I don't have Hitler Dog, I've got What cartoon is that? That's Marvin the Martian merged with whoever says, there's no need to fear. Underdog is here. That's kind of fun, isn't it? I should just join the New World Order, go to Hollywood, and make $1 million per movie on voiceovers. And I'm not bragging, folks. People say I do this for money. I've been paid $800,000 in a year for a voiceover for a national ad. That's how much those unions pay you, because they air the commercial thousands of times on national TV. And I got, like, checks, big checks every month for it. And then after a year, there was a backlash, and they said, that's Alex Jones's voice. We don't like your company having Alex Jones's voice. I got insurance companies want me to do the voices. They want me to be the guy that says, you know, the big movie trailers coming this November. But I don't do it. I stay here, and I do this. But I tell you, it's a very pleasurable feeling that I don't need to be successful just as a radio talk show host or Patriot. I do this because I choose to. I can make more money doing voiceovers. I'd probably be one of the top voiceover people in the world if I wanted to. And I'll tell you what's even better about that. I don't even sit here and do a fake voice on air. This is my real voice right here. I bet I could sit there with a radio voice that Glenn Beck wishes he could do. But I'm not going to do it. And I'm not bragging. It's no brag, just fact. It's just that I love the talents God gave me. You've got a lot of talents as well. YouTube doesn't have the talent of downloading my video, Hitler Dog. There's no need to fear. Sorry. We're going to return. I can do Cobra Commander.
Cobra.
My voice is kind of shot, though. It's hard to do it. Autobots transform and roll out. Bumblebee, open fire. He came to your planet with the cube to save your species. Autobots transform and roll out. This is CNN. Closed caption provided by Bud Atlantic, the heart of closed caption communication. By the way, again, I'm a free market guy. I'm not one of these socialists that's ashamed of people writing a book or making a better car and making a bunch of money. That's free market. It makes our world better. I'm against crony capitalism allied with socialism. But when I talked about the time, I've been paid $100,000 for a voiceover was the second biggest I ever got paid. But I never even tried to really be in voiceovers. And they wanted me to do a bunch of voiceovers for national TV shows, but, you know, it wasn't shows I wanted to be a part of. And it was high union rates. They wanted me to do movie voiceovers, you name it. And I was just simply saying, I do this not to make money. I do this because this is where my passion is. And it takes a lot of money to run this operation. In fact, I took the $800,000+ I made off that voiceover money, and I put it into InfoWars. I took it as part of InfoWars money. And my accountant goes, this is separate money. Why are you putting it back into the company? Keep it. And I said, I need $850,000+. That runs us for like a month, even back then. And it's expensive to do media. I mean, our bandwidth costs are hundreds of thousands a month, literally, and the computers and all of it. And so I put it back in. That's what it's all about. But I have a real pleasure in that I turned down a Hollywood career and voiceover career and everything. But, man, it was stuff like, they want me to play like psychotic killers and stuff. And obviously I could play a psychotic killer really good. Be a big, you know, big hit. But to quote John Goodman, I'm drinking my coffee. He wrote 127 episodes of Branded, not a lightweight. Okay. I'm getting into real Big Lebowski inside baseball right now. I need to stop it. We have a really important guest, Stefan Molyneux, on the Islamic horde takeover and why the globalists are behind it. We have a special guest joining us, investigative reporter on human slave trafficking, coming on. Paul Watson will honcho the fourth hour today. Before I go any further, I mentioned Hitler Dog. Like 4 years ago, I did a joke video when they banned the JCPenney teapot saying you could magically see Hitler. It's like seeing, you know, Mary in a bagel or whatever. Well, now you see Hitler in a bagel, you arrest whoever, you know, has the bagel. But this guy made fun of this Hitler Dog as a joke, and so he's been arrested in Scotland. I guess I could be arrested for my Hitler Dog video with my dog Captain. Here's part of it.
There is the evil teapot, and then there is my French bulldog. Now, I could have probably seen Hitler in a pile of dirt outside my house, but instead I started looking at Captain, our French bulldog, and I got to admit it, I'm like a closet Nazi because I kiss him right on his Hitler mustache. That dog gets kisses from me, okay? And for my children, they're sitting supporting Hitler. And look at him. I mean, he even looks like Hitler. His eyes kind of look like Hitler. He's got no fur on his lip, and so it looks like a Hitler mustache. That dog, JCPenney's, banned those teapots and had them destroyed. So I'm taking Captain today into the pound, and I'm going to have him, put him in a gas chamber and kill him like they do stray dogs. And I'm sad, but I'm going to prove that I'm not racist, And I'm going to sacrifice him on the altar of political correctness to prove I'm not racist and to satisfy Al Sharpton. So, Captain, should I give him lethal injection or give him the pressure chamber? I mean, I don't want him to feel any pain. I love the dog. But, I mean, he does look like Hitler. And I realize I want to apologize. Maybe I should be gassed. Because I just realized my wife and I chose a dog when he was a puppy that had a Hitler mustache because of a subconscious racism. Can we put the racism back up on air only to illustrate it and to apologize? Ladies and gentlemen, I want to apologize. Can we show my racist dog before we added the Iron Cross and the helmet, the Kaiser helmet, the World War I Field Marshal helmet? I mean, look at him, folks. That I'm so ashamed that my dog is Hitler. In fact, it may be a genetic experiment. He may actually be Adolf Alois Hitler. Perhaps he escaped to America and is hiding out. Not Argentina. No, they were all hiding at the CIA as a French bulldog. Ladies and gentlemen, even the dog tag around his neck is of a bone. The Nazi skull and crossbones had a skull above a bone. Oh my gosh, he is wearing a Nazi necklace. Folks, this is just as bad as the teapot. Look at that little bronze bell. That's a death's head too. Well, thank God, Jason.
We'll be back. We're going to repost Infowars.com a flashback of Hitler dog. And tie it into the new context. Coming up, folks, an exclusive interview we tape with Billy Corgan where he goes after the social justice warriors and more. Last time he was on, it was in hundreds of newspapers. They tried to attack him for pointing out that the controlled left is nothing but an authoritarian movement. Well, he got even more hardcore in this interview, and that's going to be coming up, a little bit of that in the next hour. Then we're going to premiere all of it in the fourth hour. It's 30 minutes long with Paul Joseph Watson. The full video has already been posted to Infowars.com with the headline, New Video, Billy Corgan Exposes the Tyranny of the Social Justice Warriors. It's also been tweeted at Real Alex Jones, and it's on our Facebook as well. And even though they've been trying to censor us on Facebook, and they admit they have, people have been battling back. And so instead of a video getting a million views, they started getting like 30,000 views. People learned about it, started posting it on their own, and they're back up to 500,000 to 1 million views, many of them. So once people were aware of the control and the attack, things really reversed in the other direction. See, tyranny will crush you if you don't resist it or you're not aware of it. But if, like, it's weights, you start squatting and deadlifting and bench pressing, pretty soon you walk up against a bunch of tyranny. It's like walking into the gym and you're like, high-fiving, let's go, 600 pounds on the deadlift, baby. Ah! That which doesn't kill us only makes us stronger. And I've been covering this censorship for years with Facebook. It's been intensifying the last few months. Drudge has knocked the doors down. Now the Senate is investigating it. And they want to act like they're libertarians suddenly when he's not meeting with the communist Chinese top censors learning how to do all this. Zuckerberg, who calls his users dumb effers, his people are out saying, hey, it's free market. Okay, it's our property. We're allowed to. Okay, but just admit, libertarians, conservatives, free thinkers of any type that are anti-statist, let's just say small government people, are not welcome. Okay, they're not welcome. You're all green-lighted in communist China because you play ball. I mean, there's nothing worse than Facebook when it comes to censorship other than maybe Twitter. But Google's big into it as well. So the good news is it's in the Hill newspaper. It's in the International Business Times. It's all over the news. Senate Commerce Committee launches inquiry into Facebook over trending topic censorship. Now, every day I've got like 10 articles or more without looking where high school teacher, middle school teacher in Austria arrested, indicted for saying that Muhammad promoted underage sex with young girls. I mean, it says that in the Quran. You can go after like 11-year-olds. Okay? Now, on one side, NAMBLA and the UN's pushing it is great. And the Saudis are over here with women as literal slaves. I go to malls in Austin. I've been going to since I was a kid. And it looks like I'm in the middle of Saudi Arabia. I mean, literally, women with full beekeeper suits, as Stefan Molyneux calls them, around every corner. And, I mean, it's like seeing slaves with chains around their necks. I was actually triggered for the first time in my life, to use a leftist term. I mean, I was actually freaked out because the women were looking freaked out because I had my daughters with me with their big, long, blonde hair and, you know, their little skirts on and their pretty shoes and, you know, clomping around having a good time with daddy. And, I don't go to Saudi Arabia for a reason. I have family that's been over there. They say it's scary. You preach the gospel, you get arrested. Now, at least old-fashioned atheists didn't care if Christians taught the gospel, whether you love it or hate it. The issue is We're bringing in radical Islam because they've got police chiefs and mayors all over announcing in Europe and in the UK, we're going to arrest you if you criticize Islam or the Queen or anybody else. See, the left is wanting to go authoritarian now. Oh, you're a leftist? Make a joke about your dog and Hitler? I made a joke about my dog and Hitler years ago. He looks like Hitler. He's got a little Hitler mustache. The teapot looks like Hitler. Oh, my God, ban it. He has been arrested. Michael Savage can't go to England. Now hundreds of other people can't. This is the tyranny, ladies and gentlemen. This is the insanity by design. And now mother, father, he, she, you can't have your identity. It hurts someone else. Now the word American is hateful, not just American flags. This is the destruction of language. And somebody warning about it really longer than I've been when it comes to political correctness. I mean, I've always covered political correctness, but it was so ridiculous. I thought people never buy into it. But it's being forced from the top. Is Stefan Molyneux. Free Domain Radio on YouTube, at Twitter, at Stefan Molyneux, Molyneux, freedomainradio.com. I don't need to introduce him. He's got hundreds of millions of views to his videos, a lot of fans around the world, and he himself is an atheist. But I respect him because he's not a hateful atheist. We can all have our own cosmologies, our own ideas to unify our field theory and whatever. But my problem is so-called leftist atheists who then make the state God. I can't stand big religion. I can't stand establishment religion. It's totally with the state. So I agree with a lot of real atheists on that issue, that that's a big threat. But I personally have a spiritual side. I have a relationship. I believe in higher power. But he respects that. The point is, he has piercing analysis on the history. Because I've done my research. He knows what he's talking about. And a very witty tongue when it comes to breaking down what's really happening. But you've heard me set the table here, sir, on what's going on. It seems like Is this a desperation? Because they know everybody's laughing at them, more and more real liberals like Seinfeld and John Cleese. Or is it a power trip that they're doing this? Where are we societally, globally? Why would the left ally itself with the radicalist forms of Islam that's running around jihading and murdering every Muslim that doesn't put a hood over their wife's head and chop their genitals off? I mean, why would feminist groups be defending in the news and calling me an Islamophobe because I am offended by going into a mall and seeing 50-something women all over the place with hoods over their heads with their husbands bugging their eyes out at me and staring at my daughters? I mean, I know an aggressive alien culture when I see it. It'd be like if we went to a time machine and brought back millions of Aztecs, you know, and they were suddenly eating people, you know, or Nazis were running around at the mall, you know, in SS uniforms. If I went to Barton Creek Mall and saw 40 or 50 people in Nazi uniforms, I would be offended. I'd be freaked out. I'd be, what on earth is this? Is this some type of joke? But it's so acceptable. It's a sacrament. Is it a hatred of the West? Is it a form of cuckolding? Is it a form of human cultural sacrifice to butcher the West? Stefan Molyneux, what are we currently facing?
Well, I think it's all those things and more, Alex. But just before we get started, out of sympathy for your eye issues, I just wanted to mention something, see if you can recognize this quote. It's 100 miles to Chicago. We've got a full tank of gas, half a pack of cigarettes. It's dark, and we're wearing sunglasses.
And they made fun of Nazis, so I say arrest the Blues Brothers.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I think they're united by a hatred of the free market. You know, what do the left and other radical ideologies all have in common is the desire to use the violence and the power of the state to interfere with people's free choices, who they trade with, where they go to school, where they want to live, what kind of neighbors they want to have. This is consistent through all of these ideologies. And you can see this mounting opposition growing to all of this madness where people are so bothered by other people's free choices that these busybodies want to go in there with the guns and violence of the state and order people around because other people's choices trigger them into terrible, horrifying bouts of hysterical, fainting couch Victorian nonsense. And we just have to fight back. We have to say, look, I am going to make my choices according to my rational conscience. You make your choices according to your hopefully rational conscience, and as long as neither of us is initiating force against the other, live and let live. But that is
exactly, they're saying I'm censoring because I don't like hoods over women's heads. No, if they're wearing hoods and that's their issue and they want to, that's fine, but they don't even let these women drive. They are kept captured creatures, basically like the families they find that live in basements that didn't know there was an outside world. That's slavery. That's not their right.
Well, here's the challenge. When I was growing up, and I think we're similar ages, but when I was growing up, the big fear, and rightly so, was communism. And communism was a world-dominating ideology disguised as a theoretical economic system. Now, there are theological constructs in the world right now, which the West is staring down, which are world-dominating theocratic systems disguised as a religion. And that is the challenge. That is the challenge. If people want to have different beliefs, that's fine. But if they're not willing to support the separation of church and state, then all people of good conscience, from atheists to agnostics to Christians to fundamentalists to whoever, all who oppose the separation of church and state are going to end up stifling the kind of debate that is the necessary traction for the advancement of civilization.
Well, that's right. I mean, that's the issue. If a woman is 18 years old and she wants to go live in a basement and be chained to a wall, wear a hood over her head and be beaten and have acid thrown in her face, she can sign waiver forms to do that under contracting. She has a right as an extreme libertarian. I think she has a right. People have a right to maim themselves, pour Drano in their eyes, the new sexy liberal thing. I'm not kidding, folks, if you haven't learned about this. I shouldn't have to pay for it. Somebody wants to have a sex change, knock yourself out. I'm not paying for it. But these women are born into slavery. The dominant form of Islam is taking over. Our government's allied with it. Why are Western states, or tell me if you disagree, Stefan Molyneux, why are they allying with it so feverishly?
Well, I mean, this is a long and complicated set of answers to that. The one thing I will mention is that it's been fairly well shown in monkey studies, which is really the best place to go and study political motivations. A lot of apes, when they climb up the hierarchy of political power within their own particular tribe, when they gain more resources and become more alpha, they get dopamine in the brain. Now, dopamine is a highly addictive substance within the brain. It's something that's mirrored in cocaine addiction. So people who have climbed to the top of political power are literally physical addicts to that political power. And anything which threatens that addiction is going to be viewed as a high negative to them. And of course, something has been set up where anything where white people or Western people or European people or the European-derived cultures, whenever we say our culture has great value, our history has great value, our traditions have great value, well, that's automatically racist. As if somehow you like Europe, you must inevitably hate the rest of the world, or you like America, you must hate the rest of the world. So politicians view racism as something that can dislodge them from power, which takes them away from the dopamine hit of their addiction to political power. And we would not expect sensible decisions from any drug addict. And politics is one of the most dangerous drugs of all.
Stefan, you sent over four or five articles you wanted to go over today. In fact, some of these articles I already had in my stack, dealing with world developments that kind of illustrate the point we are at right now. Let's go over some of those. Europe will soon have more Muslims than Christians. Belgium warns against making an enemy of Islam at Brussels attacks hearing. But they're here bullying us. My guys were in France and Belgium. They were no-go bullied everywhere. Joe Biggs was in Afghanistan and Iraq, never experienced something like this. London's iconic red buses declare glory to Allah. Police unleash tear gas after massive migrant brawl erupts in Paris train station. Soros fears collapse of EU due to refugee crisis, which they brought in. Europe refugee system in chaos. They want to fine folks €250,000 for each immigrant they don't let in, including people with terrorist backgrounds. UK's equalities chief, who popularized the term Islamophobia, admits, I thought Muslims would blend into Britain. I should have known better. Well, these are the useful idiots. There's a larger master plan. Let's walk through it.
Well, of course, the idea that everybody values diversity is false. Even if we say diversity or multiculturalism is a value in society, and that is certainly arguable based upon the data, Alex, but even if we say it's some magical, wonderful value for there to be multiculturalism and diversity within a country, well, those groups that come in who don't value multiculturalism and diversity won't blend. This is not really complicated.
Yeah, logic. Why won't Japan let Muslims in?
Well, because Japan wants to say Japanese. And why is it that nobody gets that angry that Japan or China or Hong Kong are not letting Muslims in? Why didn't people get angry that Saudi Arabia is not letting Muslims in? Because those countries don't suffer from the self-hating, pathological, white guilt that is used and has been used to strip mine resources from European and European-derived cultures for the past 50 years. White people feel guilty. Ooh, you're a racist. Oh, I don't want to be a racist. Here's my entire country to prove that I'm not a racist. Here's my entire culture. I'm going to open all the borders. I'm going to surrender to this massive union of church and state known as Islam just because I don't want to be called a racist. And people in the West do not have the right to sell their freedoms for the sake of political correctness. The freedoms that our ancestors fought and bled and died for, we do not have the right to give that away. That which you create, you cannot hand away or destroy. And we have all inherited these freedoms in the West, and we should be guarding them fiercely with as much emotional and intellectual energy as we can, and not handing it away because we're scared of words.
I asked you earlier, you started to get into it. Why do you think it seems like it's doubled or tripled in the absurdity just in the last year, and then almost every month it seems to be compounding to levels of sheer lunacy, but on the campuses, on the government facilities, no amount of ridiculousness from banning brown paper bags to the word mother and father. It's just, it's all like a religion. And so many people I know that call themselves leftist are just totally embracing it to the point now of if you say to someone on the street, let's go eat Mexican food, a white person will say to you, that's racist. You go, excuse me. And they go, don't say the word Mexican. And then literally I was debating it yesterday with people, and this Hispanic lady goes, no, that's like you say Chinese food, or let's go eat soul food. It's not racist. I mean, the Hispanic people aren't the ones even pushing it. It's this weird, like, witch hunt, white mental illness, you know, freak show. I don't, it's crazy, man.
Well, it's all designed. You know, what does a particularly venomous animal do when it wants to bring you down, but it's smaller? Well, it bites you and injects the paralysis, and then it can feast on you at its leisure. And I think the reality is basically that the left is trying to paralyze and stifle all debate about anything sensible. People say, oh, let's have an honest conversation about race, or let's have an honest conversation about incompatible religious beliefs. But it's not an honest conversation unless you're, sure, you know, white and feel bad. And
well said. They're just ending debate. They're stifling, putting out, you know, a smoke screen. When you talk about Islam not being compatible, there's this debate. Is it radical Islam or is it Islam? Whatever it is, I've studied history. The radical form of it is taking over and getting more radical. They kill each other everywhere they are, these Wahhabists. Why is the West allying with it? And what is political Islam? Where is it going? What do you expect to happen next, Stefan?
Well, it's going to go one of two ways. And I don't like to predict because that has an air of deterministic inevitability to it. It's going to go one of two ways, Alex, and I think that you and I and the other freedom-minded people are all on the same battalion as far as this goes. It's going to go one of two ways. Either we are going to rediscover the value and civilization and liberties of the West and defend them strongly and oppose ideologies that seek to quench those and squelch those underfoot, or they're going to win. You know, in any conflict between two groups, the most consistent group will always win. And the people who want to undo the freedoms of the West have been very consistent and very dedicated for decades. And, you know, there's an old saying that civilization rises in hobnail boots and descends in silk slippers. You know, maybe we all just got a little lazy. Maybe we just took all these freedoms for granted and assumed they were going to stick around like the laws of physics. Well, they don't. Everything that is good in this world erodes without strong rehabilitation and reinforcement. And we've just kind of gotten lazy. We're crossing our fingers. You know, there's studies that show that second and third generation Muslims in England are more radicalized than their parents. It's not only that they're not integrating, they're actually going in the opposite direction. And where does this lead? This idea that we can buy 5 more minutes peace from the verbal abuse of being called a racist or an Islamophobe, as if Islam is even a race. That's like being called a racist for criticizing communism. We all focus on this idea that we can get 5 more minutes peace and they'll just leave us alone for 5 more minutes. That has never, ever ended well in human history, to my knowledge.
That's right. And communism was funded by some of the criminal elements in the West. It's now been declassified to create a big enemy to fight with. And the PNAC documents, Dick Cheney writes, we're going to radicalize Islam, stir them up, and then have this 100-year Americana reign off fighting them. Well, I said that was immoral and evil. But what's even more evil is to actually make a deal and say, no, you're going to be the new culture, and then overrun everything that's created such incredible liberal freedom for everybody, because I'm a real liberal. I mean, you know, I mean, when you get down to brass tacks, I'm into people having their own freedoms. I mean, I have some of my own, you know, conservative views, how I want to live, but I'm liberal when I say, hey, I'm very tolerant. Hey, I'm not trying to run your life, but they want to run my life, so they're such control freaks, they want to ally with it when it's never going to ally with them. So Is this a double cross of Islam, a setup, a clash of civilizations, or what's really happening, Stefan?
Well, there are, of course, decent Muslims in the West who came to the West because they didn't like living in Muslim countries, and they wanted to be able to practice their faith free of Sharia law and some of the brutal enforcements that occur in Islamic
countries. But this is a reformation. These people are seen as heretics.
Oh, absolutely. But see, those of us in the West who value freedoms don't have the right to sell the freedoms that the Muslims who've come to the West to escape Sharia law, we don't have the right to sell their freedoms off either. What needs to happen in the West, and of course, this is something, in my opinion, as Donald Trump has talked about it as well, is that immigration as a whole has been going completely haywire for 50 or 60 years, basically since the 65 Act under Kennedy, which shifted, in particular in America, immigration from Europe, which is America's traditional feeding stock for immigration, to third world countries. And what's happened is now they've got a huge number of incompatible cultures coming in. And that's fine if you have a small number and you give them time to assimilate and integrate and find out if the experiment is
going. And if you don't give them welfare and put them in public schools, brainwashing them into race groups.
Well, that's key as well. I'm for the free movement of people, but you can either have open borders or you can have a welfare state. You can't have both.
Exactly. You can't have a free lunch and not put a wall around it.
Well, I think that's fair. And if we look at what's going on, this question that's coming up soon, right, which is the Brexit question, whether England should continue to lash itself to the decisions of the all-wise, all-powerful bureaucrats.
And let's define this. Talk about what, how the EU operates. We'll go to break and talk about Brexit. This is so big. I want to kind of shoot a flare up on this or you know, embolden this with highlighter, you know, yellow marker with Stefan Molyneux joining us from freedomainradio.com, because this is the big issue. Globalism is in crisis. You're answering the question now. It's being reversed, which is why it's pushing authoritarianism. Spend a minute as we go to break on how the euro operates.
Well, the euro is the outgrowth of the fantasy that a lot of globalists and a lot of the elites and a lot of the socialists and communists have. And the fantasy is, Alex, well, we are just one additional bureaucratic government coercive layer away from paradise. You know, four more regulations and we achieve nirvana in the West. And this, of course, is a complete disaster. And all of these additional layers of bureaucracy, all of this distancing of power from the voters and the taxpayers has produced all of the same disasters that we would expect from something like the USSR, which collapsed of its own overhead.
Stay there. Let's talk about it. Tax exempt, above the law, unelected bureaucracy, permanent government, FARO, everything in the Declaration of Independence on steroids. Stefan Molyneux, an amazing brain, is our guest. He's with us till 5 after next hour. With your questions for Stefan Molyneux or comments, we'd like to hear from you on radical Islam that is Islam now. How do we deal with it? Well, our governments have run up the white flag. They love the authoritarianism and want to marry it. Well, over our dead bodies. Stay with us. I'll get the number out when we come back. Paul Watson will host the fourth hour from London, Lundistan. And we're going to be airing the Billy Corgan interview then, a new, never-before-seen-or-heard interview. It's now up on Infowars.com and going viral. And it's good because, you know, he's seen as kind of a mainline intellectual in the past, liberal, but he's really just a free thinker, and it really freaks out the establishment when he comes out to his tens of millions of fans. And they try to intimidate music people. They try to make them shut up, Hollywood folks as well. But more and more saying, we're not liberal and we're not conservative. We're Renaissance. We're pro-human. We're pro-freedom. Call it whatever you want. We're sick of the totalitarianism of the left and the right. We're saying no. We'll go back to Stefan Molyneux here in just a moment. The toll-free number to join us on air with your question or comment for Stefan Molyneux, I'm your host, Alex Jones, is 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. Ladies and gentlemen, we believe we've developed the very best vitamin mineral fusion out there. That's why it's called vitamin mineral fusion. It doesn't just have all the vitamins and minerals. It has amazing amino acids that help your body actually download it. It doesn't have any unnatural flavors or colors. It is fruit punch flavored. It is amazing. It's flavored by the vitamins and minerals that are in it. It's incredible. Like take vitamin B12. It's a great flavor. Methylcobalamin. It's so good. And it is concentrated. So it's one little scoop makes like three big glasses or more. Like two scoops makes a whole pitcher. And this is what my children drink instead of you know, the garbage that's out there that's artificially sweetened. It's been sold out since the first run came in. It's got almost five-star reviews at InfoWarsLife.com. A big shipment came in. Try some of it today. Give it as a gift, especially to older folks that are trying to take multivitamins where the gut doesn't absorb it. That's such an absorption problem. When something's liquid, it absorbs a lot better. There's much better absorption. InfoWarsLife.com.
We also have Anthroplex, a lot of known herbs to help boost your body's own hormone output and make you so, it's changed my life. I've lost so much weight, I have so much more health. Also, we have the special on the food that was so popular, we ran for a week and a half. It's back, but on the top four best sellers. This is insurance you can eat. The globalists want us destabilized. They want us dependent. They're bringing us into a world depression. They're starting all these wars. Elites are getting armored redoubts and storable food. So are police departments. That's all in the news. I'm not saying all this is going to happen, but it's something in case things unravel that you need to take care of yourself, your friends, your family, and others. So InfoWarsStore.com is the big umbrella site where you can find the InfoWars Select Storable Food. That's the entire family of My Patriot. You have the full selection of My Patriot. Already, it's a great deal as well. But on the top four bestsellers of InfoWars Select, I can go even lower because it's private labeled. Now is the time to not procrastinate and get your storable food today. Plus, the profit we make funds this operation. And when I talk about what I've done in some Hollywood movies when I got invited to be in them, or when I did voiceovers nationally, and I took the profits that I had from that, put it right back into InfoWars and building this operation, because there's nothing wrong with making money. There's nothing wrong with being secure and being self-sufficient. But for me, it's about securing intellectual freedom and freedom of assembly and freedom of association and freedom of men and women to live like they want as long as they don't hurt somebody else. And that's all fundamentally under attack by radical Islam. And you see the West again. Stefan, you wanted to get into these Muslim police chiefs in Europe arresting people, but also mainline Green Party's even worse, allied with them. The new Muslim mayor saying, we don't need, quote, Uncle Tom Muslims. We need radicals. And this is what's pushed. And I've been in London a lot. I've been to London like five or six times. But when I went there in 2005 for the first time to cover the London bombing, which had been provocateured, and I was there, the Muslims weren't as aggressive and mean. But I've been there like four or five times after. They're very aggressive and getting a lot of folks' face. And when you get to the airport, you know the price it's supposed to be to your hotel. And they'll all get together and go, no, triple. And then you've got to wait, I'm sorry, till somebody from the UK shows up. And they go, no, I know, it's horrible, it's illegal. They're not supposed to do that, but they do that because they hate Westerners so much. And it's just when people are hating you and you've been taught to be liberal and to spread your legs metaphysically and culturally to it, and that doesn't even please them. It only makes them know you're weak, you're here to roll over, and they come from countries where they're killing each other and can't even get civilization. It's just like, what is the elite thinking? Stefan?
Well, there's always the, at least to me, the implied and implicit threat, right? So what, a day or two after Sadiq Khan became the Muslim mayor of London, he tweeted out, said, Trump's ignorant view of Islam could make both our countries less safe. It risks alienating mainstream Muslims. Well, that's sort of like, you know, nice little democracy you got going on here. It'd be a real shame if something happened to it, like if it caught fire or something. I mean, this is terrible stuff. I mean, this idea that, and this is not just with Islam, this is throughout the left and the Green Movement as well, who have some prominent people in the Green Movement are all for massive human depopulation. They've talked about criminal charges against people who are skeptical of the Mad Hatter pseudoscience of global warming. And this idea that people who disagree with you should end up in jail is so fundamentally against the Western tradition of free speech, goes all the way back John Milton with Areopagitica, who made the case that the best cure for bad ideas is public exposure. If people have bad ideas, offensive ideas, let's get them out into the open. Let's have them debate, because they assumed people had the rational critical thinking skills to separate good arguments from bad arguments. But one of the fundamental problems, Alex, as you know, that's happened in the West is government schools have gotten worse and worse and worse. And now a lot of people, I think particularly the elites, no longer trust the average person in the West to be able to distinguish a good argument from a bad argument, facts from fantasies, empiricism from nonsense. And therefore, because you don't trust the people to know a good idea from a bad idea, you have to control what the people have access to. And we see this happening all over. You know, the leftists, they're all, we're so into diversity. Boy, diversity and multiculturalism is so great. Yeah. When was the last time the New York Times put an ad out saying, we need a libertarian or a Republican on our editorial page because we're all leftists? So we really want to branch out. When was the last time academia said, we really want to hire someone in the social sciences? Let's make sure that they're into some libertarian or Republican philosophy. They don't. They don't. And that's so fundamental. The left has no interest in diversity whatsoever. What they do want to do is bring incompatible cultures together so that they control people who say, I don't know that this experiment is going to work really well. And they could say, ah, you're a racist, you're a bigot. And that's the way that they...
And then they can also referee, they can referee the ensuing crisis that comes out of it.
Yeah.
It's like a chemistry set, taking five or six things you know are going to explode and going, you need to buy bomb insurance, blows up. See, I told you.
Well, so let's take the refugee. That's the big crisis. We started talking about the EU. There are two problems that the European Union has had to deal with that are the most important, I think. Number one was the financial crisis. And the financial crisis basically came about because Germany, by being a relatively responsible country, had very low interest rates because it didn't have a very high debt to GDP ratio. And a lot of the other countries, yes, I'm looking at the pigs, right? Portugal, Ireland, Greece, and Spain, and so on. A lot of the other countries who had bad interest rates wanted to hook into German interest rates so they could borrow at a lower rate. Sure, I mean, if I'm an irresponsible spendthrift and you're a responsible person, I want us to split the difference in our interest rates. That hurts you, but benefits me. And so the EU extended, after Greece in particular used Goldman Sachs to lie and falsify its records in order to get into the EU, these countries that had bad spending habits hooked into more responsible countries' interest rates and blew themselves up in an orgy of fiat currency spending. And then when they ran out of money and the crap hit the fan, they started threatening Europe with bailouts. And in particular, Greece threatened Europe with flooding it with third world migrants unless they paid up. And that, if that's not a mafia style shakedown, and this should have come from Italy, if that's not a mafia style shakedown, I don't know what is. So the financial crisis led to the migrant crisis, and it's all turning into a complete disaster. And that which was supposed to unify and solve most of the problems in Europe has now turned into the sword of Damocles that is actually hanging right over the neck of European civilization, which has survived for thousands of years, but might not be able to survive the collectivism of Brussels.
Continue before we go to calls. I know you've got a lot of angles, a lot of points. I've kind of been bringing up some of my own questions here, Stefan, but what are some of the other angles you want to alert people to?
Well, there's this idea in Europe, in the EU. Sorry, I was waiting for your big speech. I'm shocked that it came back to me, but I can do it. I can hang it. So in the EU, there's this idea that if you want to have free trade, somehow that involves universal citizenship. There's no other country in the world that I know of that pursues this at least as strongly as the EU does. You know, I order something from China and I open it up. I don't get a Chinese passport in there as well. Free trade and the unfettered movement of people is something that is in no way related. And trying to unite these two has been a complete disaster. Of course, also in the refugee situation, according to the European statutes, the refugee, if they're genuinely an asylum seeker or fleeing war, they must stay in the first country they land in. They're not allowed to go welfare shopping, as substantial proportions of them do, which is why they want to get, say, to Germany, which has a very strong welfare state, and away from Italy, which is much more restrictive and doesn't take as many asylum applications. So a basic rule is you've got to stay in the first country that you land in, and that has been almost nowhere enforced in the euro. There are so many other restrictions that the euro is supposed to put on its member states, like your debt to GDP is supposed to stay low. Many countries have blown past that with no repercussions, no ramifications whatsoever. So when England is thinking of leaving the EU, I would ask the British people, what is the EU? Is it a set of rules? Well, if those rules aren't enforced, can it even be said to exist? It is a massive pension fattening scheme for the useless, loathsome, spotty behind bureaucrats that infest.
That's right. And you got interrupted by the break getting into the type of tyranny that the EU is involved in. I mean, the UK and most other countries never voted to enter it. They're in it. It makes most of your laws. And then it threatens giant £250,000 fines if you don't accept whoever they say and even try to vet them. I mean, it's like, we're all powerful. Take these people. We're going to fine you. You never voted to enter us, and we rule you now. It's so dictatorial. And the fact that the Brexit's happening is so exciting.
Okay, so if you're a British business, right, small to medium-sized business, about 5% of those businesses in the UK trade with the EU. But 100% of those businesses are subject to the endless conveyor belt of tiny print, two-point squinto vision regulations coming out of Brussels. Since 2010, the EU has introduced over 3,500 new laws affecting British business. Now, if you're a giant corporation, well, you have a big legal department, you can do your regulatory capture and get the ear of the bureaucrats and offer them whatever incentives you could. So big companies, they don't mind it so much, but it's the small to medium-sized companies that end up being drowned, literally drowned, under this deluge of regulations. When Britain first joined the EU, it had 20% of the votes. Now it's down below 10%. There are hundreds of new laws and regulations that the British MPs strongly oppose, which get passed anyway. England has given away its sovereignty. That is such an astonishing thing. The British pound is one of the few fiat or semi-fiat currencies that has survived for 400 years. British sovereignty as an island, I grew up in England, was something that was considered to be one of the greatest treasures that God, nature, and geography had provided a civilized race. And the idea that in a decade or two, England would have given away its sovereignty to unelected, unaccountable people in Brussels. They suffer no negative consequences for their unbelievably terrible decisions. The idea that you would cede sovereignty to faceless bureaucrats in another country is unbelievably astonishing to me. And as soon as the British people wake up to what's happening, the vote that's coming up should be a no-brainer.
For the average low-level leftist, I think a lot of them are just in a cult and they just follow whatever the latest trendy directives are. And they're kind of scared. I've talked to a lot of them and no political correctness is getting really weird. But still, they really think that if they don't go along with it, they'll get in trouble. It's all just intimidation. They should just get off the cult. They should leave the reservation.
Well, look, if I say my arguments are good, otherwise shadowy, unknown, apocalyptic disaster occurs, that's usually an indication that my arguments aren't really good. Like, I don't need to say to you, Alex, you know, two and two make four, and if you don't believe me, your studio is going to collapse, right? I mean, if I have a good argument, I have a good argument. You've got David Cameron now going around saying, if England leaves the EU, war across Europe, conflagrations, destructions, genocides. I mean, this is apocalypse. This is Pascal's wager. Ooh, massive disasters occur if you don't obey my particular political opinion. This is all madness. The idea, and this is another example of how one government program which fails is supposed to lead to another one. Wasn't the agency or the group that was supposed to keep European peace called NATO? And hasn't that done a pretty good job since the Second World War of keeping European peace, along, of course, with the mutually assured destruction and the spread of the free market to some degree? But the idea that now, if England leaves the EU, there will be war. I mean, it's like, this has become completely lunatic. In other words, if there are borders, there are wars. Well, that's insane. When countries tend to blend together that don't fit, that's when the greatest conflict occurs. If you look at what happened in Bosnia and Serbia.
Sure, of course. They want crisis. They want war. They want consolidation. That's why they're creating order out of chaos, which gives them more power and more control. I don't see this going well for them. You know, the BRICS exit, the Brexit, all of this, I think, signals the death of globalism. And somebody like Donald Trump comes along and says globalism is bad. It's a one-sided deal. And then they get so angry at him and try to say he's a racist. It just shows that it's a military brainwashing system.
Well, I mean, Donald Trump's, frankly, in my view, magnificent foreign speech policy, where he said that America was going to withdraw from the idea of nation building. Nation building got an unfairly good reputation after the Second World War, after the massive bombings in Germany and in Japan. Those cultures reformulated themselves from, you know, pretty fascistic and psychotic, warmongering, lunatic cultures to relatively peaceful, relatively secular, free market democracies. Now that, you know, this has the whole thing to do with the average IQ of nations. You know, if you blow up Germany and you blow up Japan, really smart people go, well, that's a really, really bad thing. And therefore they end up reconstituting their societies along more peaceful and, I dare say, Western lines. However, there are people or groups that if you dismantle their existing societies, you don't get post-World War II Japan, and you don't get post-World War II Germany.
They degenerate even worse.
You get ISIS. Yeah, you get ISIS. Some people, when bad things happen to them, they make better decisions. Other people, when bad things happen to them, well, they just make worse and worse decisions. And again, I've talked about ethnicity and IQ, and people can just look up IQ around the world. There may be some reasons for this. I don't know. Nobody knows the exact reasons for it, but it's not a bad place to start. So the idea that Donald Trump is saying America's foreign policy is going to be determined by that which is good for America, rather than these globalist fantasies of walking around the world like some ironclad Iron Man Julius Caesar, waving your magic wand of violence to create paradise. My God, that's taken too long for America to take that perspective back, and I hope that he follows through on it.
Well, with all the nuclear weapons and things we've got to stop having these wars. And all I know is globalists claim globalism is going to stop war. All it's doing is starting more war.
Well, but, you know, the other thing, and I said this many years ago, another thing I think that's important, Alex, I think it's hard to look at Western politics at the moment without understanding the basic fact that the governments are out of money. And when you're out of money, you provoke a war. That's what always happens.
That's right. Stefan, stay there. We're going to be back with more of these important topics straight ahead. Infowars.com is our website, one of the top news sites in the world. Not just alternative, one of the top news sites in the world. And the system wants to censor it. Please remember, don't take this broadcast for granted. The globalists want to shut it down. Use it or lose it. Stay with us. Stefan Molyneux is with us for six more minutes in this segment, five more in the next, and he's gone. We've got an expert coming on. A journalist on white slavery going on worldwide. And every time I say that, ignorant people go, why don't you care about black slavery? White slavery, sex slavery, folks, okay, and children. So that's coming up very, very important. It's worse than it's ever been. Islam all over the world's running it in like, what, 8-9 countries still have it legal. But that's okay. I'm the problem because I think everybody should have equal freedom. It's crazy. I want to go to John and a few other callers. Stefan wants to get into the left and leftist atheism as well. I know he's an expert on that, but briefly, real fast, John in California, you're on the air with Stefan Molyneux of freedomainradio.com.
Thanks, guys. Good to talk to you. I had a question about the recent administration's decision to start cooperating with Iran in the negotiations that are somehow easing relations with the countries. Is this a stand down like they did with Libya, or is there some other sort of game plan that's going on?
Sure, I don't want a war with Iran, but and so I say leave them alone, but it is a one-sided weird deal. There's something going on behind it. Stefan, you're a smart guy. What do you think's going on?
Well, it is, of course, the history of Americans' relationship with Iran is long and complex and generally does not look that great for America. I think that in order to understand what it's like to deal with Islamic countries and Islamic fundamentalists, you simply need to understand the life of Muhammad and you need to read your Quran. And Islam, like a lot of ideologies in the world, creates an us versus them mentality. Those within the group are good. Those who are on the outside of the group are not good. And your moral obligations, this is one of the problems I have with atheists and one of the huge amounts of respects that I have for Christianity. Christianity has a universal ethical standard. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Not do unto other Christians, but do unto others as a whole. And you have to be wary when you're dealing with philosophies that say, I have no moral obligations that extend beyond my own particular group. Those are very slippery and dangerous people to try and get into deals with because you don't have the hook.
Well, it creates like an artificial psychopathic or sociopath position where this isn't a human, you've dehumanized them, you know, like the Nazis or whatever, or you're not a communist, I'm going to kill you, you're not a Muslim, I'm going to kill you, or you're not a radical enough Muslim, I'm going to kill you. It's an excuse to run wild. That's a great question and a segue into your point on leftist atheists. What's your view on them?
Well, the question is, why has everything become so hysterical and coercive and verbally abusive with people getting arrested for talking about various factual things about other ideologies? I think one of the fundamental reasons is that atheists as a whole have hacked at the idea of a personal conscience. Christianity, one of the great glories of Christianity is the degree to which it encourages people to be good and internalizes the standards of virtue so that people pursue virtue for the sake of being closer to God, for the sake of getting into heaven and so on. It internalizes the conscience. When atheism came along and said, well, to heck with Christianity, they also said to some degree, to heck with the foundation and structure and support.
That's right. They say we're animals and just programmable. But well, then I'm just programmed by the government. I mean, that's not true. I do have free will. I am innate. I can create. I mean, it's almost like saying atheists don't want to believe that humans could do incredible stuff. I'm saying we're made in the image of God. We can do amazing things. I like that superhero aspect. They're saying, no, no, you're just nothing. Decisions have already been made for you. And it seems like a kind of an anthill type cult or something is another religion.
Well, society has got to be organized in some fashion. I mean, we have to organize society. And you can say, well, we're going to get rid of the conscience. We're going to get rid of the Christian fealty to virtue. But what do you replace it with? And I would argue and have argued in a recent series of videos that what atheists replace the Christian conscience with is the edicts of state power. I call them statheists because they're atheists in that they don't believe in what they consider one irrational authority, but they replace it with a far more dangerous irrational authority called the state. You can be religious, I cannot be religious, we can both live peacefully side by side, but if you believe that the state should organize my life, we're going to come into conflict.
That's right. So really, that's why the radical left and atheists are now allying with Islam so much, is just another authoritarian, state-worshipping death cult. We'll be back. I mean, anything can turn into a cult, folks. We got one more segment with Stefan Molyneux. Powerful points he's making. Very thought-provoking. Stay with us. Stefan Molyneux is our guest. I'm wearing sunglasses today because I cut my eye a few days ago with some sand or grit that got in it swimming in a creek and got a little infected, so I can't really look into the light too good. So I've got glasses on. I'm not trying to act like the Blues Brothers. I'm not that cool. Let's take a call from the Great North. From John in Canada. John, go ahead and make your point.
Yeah, good day, Alex. Good day, Steph. Right now in Canada, I see a lot of Syrian refugees coming in. They decide to take Muslims over precedence over the cops and Yazidis. I'm a vet, so I've worked on Syrian issues before. And I'm just wondering, what can we do now that we've been given this big blank muffin to chew on? You know, we don't want to alienate the good guys to have them become radicalized later.
That's the excuse. Bring a bunch in from radical areas, be nice to them so they're not radical. Stefan was covering that earlier. It doesn't help. It makes them worse. That's what the studies show. And so the question is, the immigration level is much bigger than they're admitting. We've proven that here in the U.S. It's probably 50 times what they're saying. I mean, each high school has like 200-plus people. They claim the whole state has 400 refugees. Austin's got tens of thousands. I mean, you ought to go to the mall. It's like I live in, you know, Baghdad or something. I'm not even Baghdad. It's like I live in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. I appreciate your call, sir, from Canada. What do you make of what he's saying? Because, I mean, the numbers are much larger, which shows me it is a secretive program. They admit Europe covered up the real numbers. What's going on here?
Look, if we say that we must self-censor because other people might get upset, we've already lost free speech. Fascism finally emerges after people have been silenced already, and that way they have very little left to lose.
Yes.
And so we must continue to speak the truth. I really dislike the idea that we can't criticize groups because it might upset them. Hey, as a white male, I've taken a lot of criticism over the years, a white patriarch, racist, you know, whatever. And nobody's really caring that much about my feelings, so I'm really not sure that I should overly work myself.
Well, I was about to say, I used to be more politically correct because I was mainly covering globalism, the New World Order, the Federal Reserve, big issues. But now it's gotten so bullying, so out of control. I know I've got to show folks to have the courage to practice the First Amendment or we're going to lose it.
Well, and the other thing, too, look, I think everybody with compassion looks at the wreckage that American foreign policy and aggression has wreaked in the Middle East. I mean,
we feel sorry and say bring them in, but the same folks that did that are the ones bringing them in.
Well, here's the thing, though. Look, if those wars were justified, then you don't take the victims of war. If those wars were not justified, as I believe they weren't, then maybe you can start looking into war crimes trials for your own leaders.
That's right. Know. Let's execute the people that launched the phony wars. Let's not blame the country and then bring the people in.
So if you care about the refugees, and I do, then you look at it rationally and critically, and you say, what is more expensive? We have finite resources. In all societies, we have finite resources. How can we best help those people? Well, studies have shown very clearly it costs about $1,000 to resettle a migrant in the Middle East. And in the U.S., it costs $13,000 to bring them to the U.S. And that's just short term. The numbers go up from there. So if you want to help people in the Middle East, talk to your governments and say, let's take our tax money or let's take our private charity and help the Muslims resettle in the Middle East to countries that have the same
language, but I mean, this final point, Stefan. 80% are military-age men. Most of them are people that invaded Syria. Now they're getting their butt kicked by the Russians, so they're going into Turkey. And they're being used as a political tool. They're getting more money than citizens get. And most of them are radical Wahhabists. They're not letting Shiites or Christians who need to get out in. Have you noticed that?
Well, the Prime Minister of Canada was willing to accept Christians, and well, then he got voted out. So Christianity is compatible with Christianity. This should not be brain surgery, right? I mean, if you're going to hire someone to answer your phones, it helps if they speak your language.
That's right. Stefan, so great job. Thanks for your work. Stefan Molyneux. We'll be back. The article's up on Infowars.com. New video premieres. Smashing Pumpkins founder Billy Corgan warns of the threat to liberty posed by social justice warrior movement. Smashing Pumpkins founder, breaks down the social justice warrior movement. And we can also add an addendum that he's also pointing out that this Facebook situation where they've been caught censoring anything that's not pro-New World Order, world government, anything libertarian, anything conservative, anything even anti-war. They're funding Black Lives Matter. It's all a big destabilization program. And so I'm going to air part of this 33-minute interview now, and then when Paul Watson takes over in the fourth hour, we're going to air the rest of it for the radio and TV audience. But the full video is now up on InfoWars.com. And it's an interesting interview. He's a smart guy. Sold 40, 50 million records. Has a lot of great fans. But he's able to reach out to liberals and I don't want to say trendies, but, a lot of folks that wouldn't be into patriot politics. And, of course, we had his doctor on last week. What a smart lady getting into vaccines, medical doctor. Billy Corgan's a cool guy. I don't just have people on because they're famous. I have people on because they're smart, but also because he understands how media works. He's seen it all in Hollywood, in entertainment, in music. And people get persecuted when they speak out, when they come out and talk about these issues. And he was attacked. He was here about a month ago, a little less than a month ago, did a big interview here, but wanted to say even more. So we taped this. So this is a lot of the stuff he didn't say while he was on air with us. We're going to play part of this right now. And we've got a special guest joining us who's dealing with white slavery worldwide. Very, very powerful information coming up on that front. But again, this article's on Facebook. It's on Twitter. Let's get this Billy Corgan out to everybody so the mainstream media picks it up again, demonizes it, attacks it, and it blows up in their face. Hundreds of articles, big TV shows. Billy Corgan says social justice warriors are like the KKK. They're suppressing speech. They're a threat. Then even Rolling Stone and a bunch of the publications said he's right. It's true. Seinfeld's coming out. All these other people saying, John Cleese, countless others, saying it's out of control. It is. We can defeat this culture war to shut down free speech when more people have courage, like Billy Corgan. Again, I'm Alex Jones. The news website's InfoWars.com. With all this intensifying censorship, we can't get articles out to you on Facebook or videos out to you, or they block them being shared. Go sign up for the free emails. We can send you these exclusive videos, the exclusive articles, the top, most important stuff we're doing every day, plus promo codes, sometimes 40, 50% off on products every week at InfoWarsStore.com, on amazing products, on nutraceuticals, on Patriot Apparel, Hillary for Prison shirts, InfoWars.com/newsletter. Just put in your email there. We've got it. We can stay in contact with you and get around the censors. Now let's go to part of this powerful Billy Corgan interview.
Welcome to the InfoWars Nightly News. This is a very special report. Joining me in studio now is musical icon and great patriot Billy Corgan of Smashing Pumpkins fame. Now you've obviously sold millions of records, you're back on the road, and now you are joining us here in our new studio here in Austin, Texas. Welcome back.
But this is the new old news.
Yes.
Studio,
so. Yeah, all the fans out there, all of your support helped to build this place. It's no longer a deep, dark cave of sadness.
It actually feels welcoming. Before it was sort of foreboding.
Yes, very much foreboding, you know, which could be fitting sometimes within the info war. But so now you were on the Alex Jones show earlier today, and I thought it was just really prescient, speaking about breaking people out of this trance. And, you know, I feel like we're truly living the Orwellian nightmare. And it's almost as if it's been programmed and preparing us for this. And the Matrix is here.
Yeah, it's really bizarre to me because I grew up, I was born in 1967. And in school, at a very young age, we read Animal Farm and we read 1984. And of course, what I took from that is, this is never gonna happen in America. And we had to all take the Constitution test. So whether I was being propagandized in the positive, I was being informed that America is not like this. To actually see, in my lifetime, America go from the world that I believed in then to the world I see now is literally mind-blowing. And to be participating not only as at the citizen level, in the local community level. You know, I have a business where I live in outside of Chicago, and so I deal with the local government and that type of stuff. But then also be a public person and be part of the zeitgeist at different times, to be used and abused positively and negatively within the systems that exist today, and see how my participation is a constant decision making between either am I helping, am I hurting, am I informing, or am I actually enslaving. that's a difficult thing to take on. Yeah, so to learn that, you know, what the collectivist vision in Animal Farm in 1984 is was actually our future and not this preventative thing kind of blows my mind. I can't believe we're even having this discussion, if you can understand why I say that to you humbly. To be talking in America about, in 2016, you know, about, you know, Mao's a good idea and a socialist is running for president and that's okay. And we're going to go back to these kind of crazy tax rates where we're going to completely disempower the innovators in our country because the new class, the new technocratic class wants to keep their position and they want to keep anybody else from coming in the game. I mean, it's just crazy to me. So,
yeah. How do you think people can get around the millions of people that were murdered under these communist regimes and just say, well, you know, that just happened then.
But here's the thing. You know, obviously I listen to you and I listen to Alex and I listen to David Knight and Jakari. I mean, you guys do a fine job of identifying the factual route. And of course, sometimes because you don't have all the information, you have to speculate. And as I once told Alex, literally sitting in this exact spot, you don't always have to be right. You just have to have the right intention to want to get to the truth. As long as you want to get to the truth and that's your intention, that's fine. But what I would say to you, and I say this very plainly to you, is that most people don't care about facts. Most people do not care about facts. I work in the entertainment business. People in the entertainment business do not care about facts. They only care about facts when it involves a gross. We spent this much. How much do we make? How much do we lose? Up until that point, it's all in their mind. So for most Americans or most people listening internationally, it is in your mind. Mm. It literally, you are fighting phantoms that do not exist. Now, if you're intelligent, which I think most people that listen to this show are, you don't see how you've been engineered and steered and people are heavily invested in convincing you of something. We all know the advertising model. Women very much understand from a very young age, you start being told, you gotta look like this, you gotta think like this, you gotta do this in your hair, blah, blah, blah. Young men, it comes a little bit later and it usually comes through sports, which is why it's so heavily invested in sports, the beer, the culture, the bro, the blah, 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 blah. Okay, we all understand that and we don't, it doesn't really bother us. We like when a clever ad manipulates us to want us to buy a certain product or something. What we don't realize is think about people who have trillions on the line getting you to believe a lie or lean you a certain way so that they can achieve some end that's 10 years down the road that you don't even have the read for. So imagine here's somebody like Alex Cummins and he actually has the read or he's talking to other people who have the read and they can see 10 years down the road. You sit here in this spot and you present those facts to people and they go, what does that have to do with me?
Right.
So to me, the next stage in the info war is to get at the ground level, at the cultural level, which is where most people interface with the propagandizing and the manipulation and help them understand. Because I think most people's natural human instinct when they realize they're being manipulated is to get mad. Because ultimately it's an insult to their intelligence.
Right, or to deny, 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 because they don't want to admit that they've been hacked.
Or disenfranchise their sovereign right to make an independent decision based on fact. Now, most people don't care, like I said, if they're being manipulated in buying a product. If they realize that they're ultimately enslaving themselves to a system that's not only going to hurt them, but it's going to hurt their children, that's when their instinct kicks in.
Right.
And that's when fact doesn't matter, right? So you can present people fact all day. If they are hypnotized, they are not going to hear you.
They're conditioning your children. And so you'll see some of these Disney cartoons and things like that. Mm-hmm. We spoke about Shutterbug Time, where it's this bug that's a drone that's spying on kids, and it's just conditioning them to be completely okay with constant surveillance, reporting back to central command about whatever it is that you're doing inside right. The privacy of your own
so
home.
Let's explore that for a second. Now, I'm on the entertainment side. I'm in these meetings with people. I recently had a meeting with a big studio that I might participate in. Those people at the ground level are not part of some governmental cabal.
Right.
They might even themselves be okay with those ideas. So on the realm of opinion, somebody working in a big studio could say, Leanne, I've been friends with the creator of that show for 20 years. It's got nothing to do with government surveillance, okay? And you could say, well, I disagree. So an observer would sit back and say, well, Leanne has an opinion, and this person over here who's invested in the series and put capital, and they believe in it, and they love it, and they think it's great for children or whatever. You present it as, have you thought of it like this? My perspective is, This is something that kind of, if I was a parent or thinking of my own nieces and nephews, this kind of troubles me, and here's why. So all you're doing is you're presenting kind of a range of ideas to someone and letting them make the choice whether or not that's something they want their children participating in, because maybe on their particular range of belief, they don't want their children conditioned to believe that surveillance is okay. Because even if you can make an argument for surveillance is okay, a lot of us that grew up in the 60s and 70s, we were told, don't trust strangers. Because, you know, there was a rash of a pedophile incident. I grew up around when John Wayne Gacy was killing kids. I mean, I literally lived down the road from where that happened. So you can imagine being 10 years old and hearing about kids being murdered and put in basements. I mean, it terrified us. So suddenly all the parents were like, don't trust strangers. So something as simple as that, which maybe has no...
All right.
Nefarious undertone.
Let's fade that down.
Still, at some point, a parent might say,
we're going to come back with more of the interview and then finish it with Paul Joseph Watson. We'll air it all tonight in the nightly news as well. It's a very powerful interview, and we're working on with Billy every week having him do maybe 5-10 minutes of commentary on popular media to show the propaganda. Like he's mentioning one serial killer, suddenly everybody's scared, thinks it's an epidemic. One great white shark attack, then on the coastline of, say, California, and for a year, half the tourism goes down to people surfing or swimming. I mean, it's just total hysteria. It's mind control. Joe Biggs did a really powerful one-minute Benghazi video that's like a fake campaign commercial satire on Hillary Clinton. We're going to play that coming out of the next break. We have a special guest joining us. I want to air 4 or 5 more minutes of this very powerful Billy Corgan interview. Really appreciate his courage to talk about these type of issues when they boycott people, they go after folks, when they stand up for the truth. But we're going to lose everything if people don't start having courage like Billy Corgan. Because there's, for every Billy Corgan out there, there's 50 other big stars that are just scared. And it's so sad. But let's go ahead and go back to more of this interview that Leanne McAdoo conducted. And again, this was about 3 weeks ago. We're premiering it now. And notice how he's talking about Facebook and things. Now that's in the news. Talk about having your finger on the pulse. Here it is.
That's telling it's okay to be observed by a stranger. And that's not to assign a nefarious intent to the creator, and it's not to say you have to be right. You can just raise the question, and it's really more about the cultural discussion of whether it's appropriate in the wider culture to accept these ideas as normalized, which is where I get funky on that.
Right.
I don't like the normalization of things that really need heavy, intense peer and cultural review before we kind of stamp and say, that's okay. Drones, for example, is something, as particularly as a person in public life, and I would guess you as a young woman, that's a troubling thing. If you have to think every time you're near an open window and you're taking off or putting on your clothes or you're picking your nose or something, you have to think, is somebody watching me? And is this going to end up on a system? And is that 10 seconds going to haunt me for the rest of my life, particularly in social media world where I can be tagged? And basically, you work here, you're a public person. So those are issues you have to think through. So why isn't there a greater cultural peer review about the proper use of drones in situations? Why isn't there a more wide-ranging discussion? That, to me, is a discussion we should have as citizens.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, I know, for instance, when I switched over my phone to an Android, not even thinking about it, I didn't realize that you had to turn off all of these systems. And at one point, I just randomly discovered that my phone had been tracking my most visited places. And hey, isn't this great? Don't you want everyone to know where you work, where you live, where you shop? No, I don't want any. I mean, that's... Yeah. It's frightening to me.
At one point, I'd link some social media thing to my phone. And as you can imagine, I have a lot of famous people in my phone. And that social media system went in my phone because I downloaded the app and poached all the names and had posted them on the internet. And I remember talking to somebody from the company, and they were like, well, that was our private. In the hacking world?
No, exactly.
Hello?
Yeah, it's not private to people who have broken into the government office there in the Pentagon and have exposed your private
information. These are things that we should discuss. So I like the idea and pushing for, I think you're the perfect person to approach this from that systemic review, from the standpoint of the info war. Are we okay? Here's a new show. Are we comfortable with these concepts? Here's a movie where the director of the movie is openly called for open borders. Mm-hmm. Are we okay with that? Are we okay with the messaging in the movie? Is that okay? Do we want to participate that on a cultural level? And I'm not calling for boycotts. I'm an artist. I'm calling for an open, free society that deals with these ideas equally and fairly, and that collectively, in the right use of the word, we can come to a better cultural point of view. I mean, it's pretty remarkable that, like, literally, okay, I'm talking to you, right? I could say one word right now that would destroy my career. I could use the wrong racial epithet or say the wrong thing to you or look down at the wrong part of your body and be castigated and it's a meme and I'm a horrible person. Every day, through the media, through advertising, we see people being degraded. We see people doing all sorts of things that we should be horrified as a culture. So we've normalized all sorts of things. But now we live in a world where one word can destroy your life,
right.
But it's okay to, if you're a social justice warrior, spit in somebody's face.
Right.
That's okay, because you have, you're a victim, so it's okay.
Right.
So under the same ideology, I didn't like the way you spoke to me early, so I should be able to denigrate you, because that's okay. I mean, that's where we're losing the plot, and quickly, too, I would add.
Right. Well, and that's something that is kind of a big issue right now, is it's this whole cultural racial thing where you can't say anything if you're white. There was actually the White Privilege Conference that just took place, the 17th annual one, who knew? But
God, I didn't get my invitation.
No, I know. So, but there was a woman who had attended, and she was tweeting out how the white speaker took too long, and that's like the
I actually did read that.
Perfect example of white privilege. And he went over his time.
And that's a perfect example, okay? I'm the type of person, I saw that report, I was fascinated by it. I actually went to the woman's Twitter account and I read a bunch of her tweets, because as somebody in public life, I know not to just take.
We're going
to
back this up a few minutes and play the rest of it coming up at the bottom of the next hour when Paul Watson's hosting. I mean, Billy Corgan is just really knows what he's talking about. He's talking about having a cultural debate about how we're being manipulated and bringing back the social contract to say, what do we really want as a society and a civilization? But we're going to talk to a suppressed journalist, investigative reporter, who couldn't get her book published forever until now, about sex slave trafficking. We're going down the rabbit hole.
Joe Biggs here with Infowars.com. Now I have some footage of Hillary Clinton that I believe will help boost her campaign into the next zone, leaving Bernie Sanders completely in the dust. Now, she did lose last night and somehow ended up getting the same amount of delegates as Bernie Sanders. But thanks to some whistleblowers, we actually have exclusive footage, never before seen footage of a Hillary Clinton ad that I believe will set her over the top. Let's take a look at that ad.
It's 3 a.m. and your children are safe and asleep. But there's a phone in the White House and it's ringing. Something's happening in the world.
Hello, Secretary Clinton. This is Ambassador Stevens. We are under attack here in Benghazi. Hello?
Hey. Your vote will decide who answers that call.
Bob, what time is it? Oh, it's 3 a.m.?
Whether it's someone who already knows the world's leaders, knows the military, someone tested and ready to lead in a dangerous war.
Oh, cool. She should answer. She said she would. Hello, we're under attack. The building's on fire. They're shooting at us. There's explosions. Where the f*** are you? You said you were going to leave us.
It's 3 a.m. and your children are safe and asleep. Who do you want answering the phone?
What difference at this point does it make?
I'm Hillary Clinton and I approve this message.
Stand up in the info war and say, I don't know what's going to happen at the end of this, but you want to fight? You better believe you've got one!
From the front lines of the information war, it's Alex Jones.
The balance of the hour before Paul Watson takes over, hosting from London, and Billy Corgan interview is premiered and completed. We are joined by a lady who I know, Ja'Kari Jackson, is definitely going to want to interview, because he's really been on the slavery beat as a reporter, documenting that slavery is just as prevalent now with sheer numbers as it was 200 years ago. It's just camouflaged a little bit better. And Conchita Sarnoff has worked with some of the biggest presidential campaigns around the world. She's been a crisis communications advisor to several Fortune 400 companies. She comes very highly recommended by Victor Ostrowski, who helped publish her book. who's a Mossad whistleblower who we've had on as a guest, who exposed Mossad false flags, but also other government criminal activities. And he helped her. He's a best-selling author, publish her book. She's an investigative journalist who spent years trying to get it out, and it's finally been published. She also focuses in on Jeffrey Epstein, or Epstein, who is at the center of the pedophile island. So Traffic King is the book, and the website is Conchita Sarnoff, C-O-N-C-H-I-T-A, Sarnoff.com. And I'm going to tweet out at Real Alex Jones and also put a link to her on Facebook, because this is important. This is just a quick 25-minute interview or so, but we will have her back as an expert to drill more into this, because I don't cover modern slavery to lessen the horrible transatlantic slave trade that killed millions of people, tens of millions of people, enslaved hundreds of millions in the aggregate, or the Arab slave trade that was even bigger, or the Roman slave trade, or the Chinese slave trade. I mean, every culture's done it. Doesn't mean it's good. We as a culture said, this is a bad contract. We don't like this. We're not doing this. But the type of slavery now is kids and women of every race, color, and creed, and the most disadvantaged, you know, people that are also grabbed out of countries and taken to islands as slave labor. Foxconn factories, Apple, the suicide nets. I mean, this is bigger than it was at the peak of slavery here in 1800. And every historian, you know, admits that. So we're so busy trying to ban the word lynch because it scares folks, the Irish name and brown paper bags, that we're not focusing in on this. But she also heads up an organization that exposes all this, atrvt.org. And, you know, the best way to break this down is she's an investigative reporter for the Daily Beast, with her expose behind the pedophile sweetheart deal, published the Daily Beast, and was submitted for the Pulitzer Prize. There's so much more to go over with her. So in the time we've got, you just take over here and break down the basics, your background, and where this rabbit hole really goes. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Alex, very much for having me on your show. I appreciate it. As you said, this has been a long journey because the establishment, both parties, Republicans and Democrats, have tried to silence the information that is included in the book. The book is more a reportage of not only my journey in the underbelly of human trafficking, but also it exposes the longest running U.S. federal human trafficking case. Here is a case that started Mr. Jeffrey Epstein, who is a registered level 3 sex offender, was arrested in 2005. He was indicted 2 years later, in October 2007, for one count of solicitation of prostitution with a minor. And the incredible thing is that they even identified the victims as prostitutes, or the victim, instead of identifying them as what they are, which is victims, because any girl aged 15, 14, 13, 16, certainly under the age of 18, should not be labeled as a prostitute. She or he should be labeled as a victim, especially when they're up against a grown adult. So here was this case that I stumbled into, having come back from Mexico and almost losing my life. I was threatened by a government official, an agency official, I was going to be lynched if I asked another question, according to the lady who I was interviewing. And after coming back from that harrowing trip, and of course, after also being offered a bribe not to write this book, I realized that this case was important on different levels. The most important level was the cover-up. I believe, in my opinion, that this cover-up was far greater than the Watergate and the Lewinsky scandal and the Profumo affair combined. I believe this is a very important case because it set precedent. The reason it has set precedent, Alex, is because we have several cases, human trafficking cases, in the state of Florida, that have tried to use the Epstein defense as their defense in order not to go to jail and in order to get less time. There's one particular case today. The defendant's name, ironically, is Archangel Michael Hernandez. He's a Hispanic male. He's clearly not rich. And in his defense, his attorney, Joel DeFabio, also from Miami, his defense claimed that because he was a poor Latino and not friendly with our former president, Bill Clinton, he is now looking at 8 to 10 years for the more some of the similar charges that were that Mr. Epstein was charged with. So here you have a case, how many years later, 2016, going back and using a 2007 defense. And that's why I thought this case, one of the reasons why this case was so important is because it now has set precedent.
Sure, them only giving Epstein a slap on the wrist when he's bringing all these presidents and world leaders out to Pedophile Island with girls as young as, what, 10 years old. This is creating a precedent to give a slap on the wrist. And listen, I'm a libertarian. I don't approve of a lot of the stuff going on, but if it's consensual and it's adults, you know, leave it alone. I mean, I'm not for drugs, but I'm for decriminalization. I'm not for prostitution, but I'm for decriminalization. But when you involve minors, I want to come down hard on folks. But it seems like with the Catholic Church or Boys Town or Penn State, when you've got a high government officials involved, it gets covered up because this is, you know, just a crime too big to be prosecuted. And so it's just amazing. I mean, how deep does this rabbit hole go? For folks that don't know, talk about some of the stuff, how young these children are, some of the numbers we're talking about here, how big this trafficking is.
Okay, well, let's start with, in 2012, Congress reported that there were 300,000 American, that is U.S.-born children being trafficked in the United States. That's in 2012. The number has now risen to 1 million. The U.N., the United Nations, claims that there are 22 million children being trafficked worldwide. That's an enormous number, however you slice it. And according to some media reports, it is a business that is worth over $167 billion. That is larger than Google, Nike, and Starbucks combined, and the profits of these three companies combined. So I believe one of the reasons this business has become so enormous and so out of control is because you've got online pornography, as you might know, Alex, is the largest business online. Child pornography is the second largest business online. Ashton Kutcher, the actor, he created a foundation called WeAreThorn.org, WeAreThorn.org, which helps the certain law enforcement agencies with data and metrics. And he's got some incredible data and facts on that website. And the reason I'm promoting it is only because it's been very useful to me and to many NGOs that work in the field. So here we have these numbers that are incredible. And by the way, the only way, the only method that we actually even have numbers today is because the victims have been arrested. The police, the local police departments are the first line of defense. So if a victim, if a child is not arrested, it cannot be identified whether it's a prostitute or a victim or a trafficker or a pimp or a John. Now, the victims prior to the last, well, I would say within the last 5 years, a lot of things have changed because the police departments have become very educated. And that is one thing that my foundation, our organization, is attempting to do. We are attempting to educate all public schools in the 15,000 school districts on how to identify traffickers online, because that's what's happening today. Traffickers are no longer sitting in a van waiting outside a school or a shopping mall or a movie theater to abduct children and traffic them. No, they're now going online, they're chatting up children, they're befriending them online. So this is
absolutely become- and I've got two daughters that are young and a son, and you know, that's why I won't let them on the internet by themselves, is because there are these predators posing in there. And I've seen, just reading the news every day for years, a pattern where it's almost always local cops, not that they're perfect, but on average less corrupt, that are actually busting the pedophiles. And so many times it's national deputy directors of Homeland Security, top FBI. And from my research, there's almost like pedophile clubs that are taking over government, just like the Catholic Church, to protect themselves and operate. And that's why they're trying to federalize local police so that they can't bust up these networks. But what I've said, does that mesh at any level with what your research has found?
Absolutely. Exactly. I mean, I believe that's one of the reasons why my book was not published for 7 years. And Random House Mexico killed the book deal in 2014. I mean, I signed a book deal in 2009. The more I dug, the more I found out, the more I exposed the less they wanted to publish the book. I have had three agents in the past X number of years. I mean, I don't want to expose everything because you could, you know.
No, I understand. You've been blocked just like Facebook admits they, you know, right. They block stuff they don't like. I mean, this is the age of stealth censorship.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, you know, so back to this case. So here we have a case where the pedophile, who is a very generous donor to the Democratic Party, was given a slap on the wrist, and he implicated a number of Democrats, and yet he was pardoned during a Republican administration, and I'm sure that those who pardoned him were also part of the Republican establishment. So you've got, you know, both parties who don't really want to expose what went behind the scenes. But when you read the book, you'll understand through the Dershowitz deposition, you know, he even implicated Harvard law professor Alan Dershowitz, one of the victims, Virginia Louise Roberts, implicated Professor Dershowitz, and they just settled the case, I believe, on April 8th. And why was this case settled right away? That's another question you'll find out in the book. But, you know, there are many questions that I tried to answer as best as I could, because this rabbit hole, as you call it, is so deep and so wide that even Alice in Wonderland would have had quite a problem trying to dig herself out of it.
Conchita Sarnoff, stay right there. We're going to come back to break and come right back to you. But I tell you, this rabbit hole goes so deep. It's so frightening to realize the type of monsters we have literally all around us that want control of our society, that want to run our lives, that want to dominate us, that want to be able to shut down the new independent media so this information doesn't come out. But we're going to cover it here on this broadcast. Of course, Bill Clinton and others went to that island that Conchita Sarnoff has been for a decade trying to expose, the last 7 years not having her book published. It's now been published, and we'll give you the details of that when we come back from break, her website, so that you can find that and get a copy of that and get that out to other folks. You may, as a viewer or listener of the show, already know all this, but other folks don't. They just don't realize the level of evil that we're dealing with. Look at the royal family, all the pedophilia in England, the highest government ministers. They don't even let you in. A lot of the folks, I've been told, don't even like this, but they have to do it to become compromised, or these mafias don't accept you. Kind of like low-level mob will say, you got to kill somebody who's innocent to be a made man. Well, that's just regular organized crime. When you get up to the highest levels of betraying countries and carrying out evil, they go all the way. So ConchitaSarnoff.com, ATRVT.org. We're going to go to break. We're going to come right back with her and more. We have our best-selling product back in stock. It is the Vitamin Mineral Fusion from InfoWarsLife.com, made by one of the top labs in the country. Totally delicious and organic. It is flavored by the vitamins and minerals that are in it, and a small dose of xylitol. Extremely healthy. All the vitamins, all the minerals, all the amino acids. Super concentrated. Other leading brands are twice the size, but the same, you know, value in there. But regardless, you absorb more of this when you drink it. Especially old folks have such absorption problems. I'm getting my grandmother on this and Secret 12. And your purchase supports the broadcast. InfoWarsLife.com takes you right to the nutraceuticals. InfoWarsStore.com is the general store with the Hillary for Prison t-shirts and the Molon Labe shirts and the books, the films, the non-GMO heirloom seeds. Thousands of items. The preparedness items, the media, the gear, the specials. It's all there. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com, Made in 1776.com is the Made in America apparel, but those are all subsites of InfoWarsStore.com. We also have 10% off. When you sign up for auto ship, cancel anytime, and it gets even better. Not just 10% off. Free shipping on all orders of $50 or more. This is an expensive media operation to run. We sell a lot of products that are high quality at low prices in the competitive market to fund ourselves the old-fashioned way, not with taxpayer money, not with big corporate money. We've got the Make America Free Again hats. We've got it all. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com. But Vitamin Mineral Fusion, so amazing, is back in, sold out in a week and a half when we first had our first run in. It's almost got five-star reviews, third-party sites like Power Reviews. Find out more today, whether it's Secret 12 or X2 or Supermale Vitality sold out, but Anthroplex is back in. Superfemale Vitality is basically the same formula as Supermale. Works just as good, in my view. So that's available. InfoWarsLife.com. And then you fund a platform to bring on amazing guests, investigative journalists, trailblazers, and heroes like our current guest. Again, I'm Alex Jones. Infowars.com is the news site. Stay with us. Our guest site is ATRVT.org. Stay with us. Conchita Sarnoff is our guest.
Nobody seemed to know.
It's our last segment with her, but I want to invite her back on the nightly news for a more in-depth report, kind of show some of the background articles and things for TV viewers. This is a radio/TV broadcast. The nightly news is 7 o'clock Central weeknights. Find details at Infowars.com/show. But take the Senate hearings now that are about to start on the admissions that Facebook selectively censors ideas they don't like but doesn't tell you. You may agree with censoring conservatives or anti-war people, but it doesn't mean that it should happen. I mean, there are tyrants out there. Just because some people want to restrict views doesn't mean they have a right to do it. And see, once that happens, now you can shut down the details of Bill Clinton's best buddy and the pedophile island that we've been exposing. Now, getting back to our guests, in the 5 minutes we have left, Conchita, what else is key for you to relay to folks that's in your books so they understand why the system was fighting so hard to suppress it?
Alex, I think one of the reasons that propelled me to move forward and to be so persistent was after the fact I met the prosecutor on Epstein's case. And as you will read in my book, I have his letter and certain documents at the beginning of the book, because I needed to relay to the readers how important this particular case is, certainly when it comes to our future and the future of our children and the future of the enforcement of the Trafficking Victims Protection Act, which is the federal law, the only federal law, one of the only federal laws, forgive me, the most important, that prosecutes traffickers and protects victims. And so when I met with R. Alex Acosta, who was the prosecutor at the time of the Epstein case, he wrote a letter. I found, through a source, I found an email that was written to one of Epstein's defense attorneys. Epstein had several defense attorneys, all very powerful and influential and certainly leaders in their fields. And so the prosecutor wrote in the letter, we, the prosecution, were assaulted, and I quote, assaulted, during the time of Epstein's investigation. Now, you tell me, Alex, when does a prosecutor, number one, when does a prosecutor usually speak to a journalist, one? Two, when does a prosecutor use the word assaulted to describe the actions of the defense attorney or defense attorneys? As
oh, absolutely. Look, the folks that went after this scumbag were heroes. I mean, this is a death sentence probably still for them. And the answer is go after the globalists at every front. Just like with the Catholic Church, we're going to end up showing that basically half of these people are pedophiles. It's a cult of pedophiles. I've studied it for two decades plus. I couldn't believe it when insiders told me 20 years ago. But, man, I tell you, it is just totally sick, totally evil, and it describes all the tyranny we see. I mean, look at this article here out of CNN. Vietnamese girls, we're talking young girls, smuggled into China and sold as child brides, little kids like 5, 6, 7 years old. Teacher to be prosecuted for calling Muhammad child molester. Breitbart. I mean, all she said was that, you know, the Quran was saying you go after 12 and 11-year-olds. So there's almost like a normalization. You talk about the UN. Some of the UN exposes it, but the UN's also been caught in its own trafficking. UN peacekeepers, Dyncor, Halliburton. We've got all that going on. We got NAMBLA trying to get recognized. I mean, there seems to be this whole hidden agenda. What's your view on that?
Yes, I totally agree with you. I mean, I find this confounding. I find the issue of human trafficking confounding in 2016. Number one, because I, like most Americans, believe that slavery, and this is simply child sex trafficking, is a form of...
Hold on, do 5 more minutes with us. We're going into overdrive. Infowars.com/show. Your station doesn't pick up the fourth hour. And the rest of the Billy Corgan exclusives coming up as well with Paul Watson. Stay with us. Our investigative journalists, Joe Biggs and Wayne Madsen, 2 days after Scalia was dead, we're down there with David Knight and everybody else, our great crew, at that secretive 20,000-acre ranch on the border. And every hallway was just lined with devil masks, weird murals of children being eaten by devils, little beds outside the rooms, all this weird stuff. And Wayne Madsen and Beggs said, this looks like Bohemian Grove. This looks like, you know, some type of real perv stuff. This was like a secret society. And then it came on the Washington Post a month later, I guess to get ahead of us. They went, yeah, it's a secret society for Bohemian Grove meeting. No big deal. So all I'm telling you is, man, we're in a lot of trouble. And there's a lot of freaks in control. And you hear about the psychopath that kills people on his own getting in trouble. But the high-level ones, they just run the show. And this rabbit hole, I mean, I remember having John DeCamp, former state senator, former CIA black ops commander in Vietnam on. And he doesn't really come on anymore. He's gotten pretty old, has some health issues. I'll just leave it at that. He wrote the Franklin cover-up. Most of what's in that book later came out. And he was on air like 15 years ago going, in Boys Town. And then I tell you, Penn State, they sell the kids out to the football program and rape them. And I took him off air. And then it all came out and was true. And, I mean, it's just those of us that aren't attracted to children and aren't attracted to Satanism, we just don't get it. Finishing up with our guest, this is really a hard subject to talk about. Ms. Sarnoff, again, has written the book. It's available on our website, ConchitaSarnoff.com or ATRVT.org. We only got a few minutes left and this segment's over, but dealing with the rabbit hole, your research, is it a cult? Is it a larger group? Or is it groups of people that take over institutions? I mean, why is it that so many big institutions end up being run by pedophiles? Universities, colleges, schools, reformatories, religious groups, military groups. I mean, what is going on from your deep research as an investigative journalist?
Well, look, Alex, I can't tell you for a fact that this is a cult. I mean, I haven't studied that, and that's interesting because that poses another question that I will now pursue. But I haven't pursued that road yet. But I will tell you that the cartels, the Mexican cartels, the Russian cartels, the Ukrainian cartels, the Chinese cartels, the Colombian cartels, these are the large networks. In the United States, you have a cartel called MS, which stands for Mara Salvatrucha. And MS works closely with several Mexican cartels. And they are definitely very involved in the trafficking.
Sure, let me ask you this question, because if Vladimir Putin can be proven to be involved, and that's a big deal, he claims he's trying to fix corruption. Is there any evidence which side of things Vladimir Putin's on?
No, I have not studied I have not read anything about Putin being involved in cartels that sell children. Whether he is or not, I can't tell you yes or no, but I have not seen anything.
Sure. What about the finders and stuff in the 80s? You know, the CIA has been directly connected to it.
Well, look, I believe that there are men in very high places, such as was proven during my 7-year research, who are involved in one way or another, directly or indirectly, whether they're protecting a pedophile or they've tried it or they're interested. They're there at every level, certainly at every socioeconomic level. In every country, you have that. You have that in the United States. You have that in France. You have that in England. You have that in Switzerland. You have that in Spain and in Italy and everywhere else, in China, Australia. So, you know, it exists. Pedophilia is a disease. As a matter of fact, there's a pharmaceutical, which I just found out, a very interesting research is going on in Stockholm at the Karolinska Institute, where they're using a drug that is currently on the market for a different indication for prostate cancer.
To block pedophilia behavior?
And
once they convict somebody, a ball peen hammer 10 or 15 times in the back of the head, too, that cures it. I want to talk to you very soon. Thank you, Conchita Sarnoff, for your courage. God bless you. You're an amazing lady. Paul Watson's coming up. I covered a lot of the news the last 3 hours, but Paul Watson's about to take over from London, my great colleague. Look at this story on Infowars.com. There's video. Vicente Fox warns of war if Trump becomes president. Former Mexican president, don't play around with us. We can jump walls. He does videos flipping people off. Mexico has a big wall and a fence, 1 year to 6 months hard labor. They torture people and fine them because they would be completely overrun if they didn't. As bad as Mexico is, Guatemala's even worse. I mean, it's just the ultimate hypocrisy. And then he knows the public's dumbed down, so he just flips everybody off and calls Trump supporter drunk Americans. I'll give you that. Americans are some of the biggest consumers of alcohol in the world. You can argue who's tops, maybe Russians, the Poles, then Mexico, the U.S. I mean, Mexicans are in the top 10, the biggest drunks, Vicente. I mean, that's pot calling kettle black, bro. Yes, we're drunks. Okay, you got us. Now look in the mirror. I think you may have us. You might actually have us. I'm not saying you're bad, but I think you may be even bigger drunks than us. I mean, you know, out of a lot of drunks, I think the Mexicans are right up there at the top. So, you know, this is absolutely ridiculous. And then he makes an apology and then, you know, does all this. It's just all to get publicity. Vicente Fox is very corrupt, in my view. Just a total joke. He tried to have me arrested. There's video of it when I was bullhorning him. But under law, the Austin police wouldn't arrest me. And so that's some pretty classic video. Before it's a big conspiracy, I'm not in the Blues Brothers. And I'm not going to Chicago with a tank of gas and a pack of cigarettes and a six-pack of beer, whatever they say in the movie. I cut my eye swimming in a stream, got some gravel in it. And it's the light is very painful to it. And put colloidal silver in it. Looks like it's getting better. Got a little secondary infection. So I am doing that right now because this baby is not too happy in the light. My eyeball is like a vampire now. It just, sunlight is excruciating. And even these lights do not feel, it's like somebody sticking their finger in my eye. Earlier, we're talking about child sex trafficking, and I'm going to be wearing sunglasses when I'm wearing that. People be like, it's almost disrespectful in the interview. So I went through the pain of it. But now that Paul Watson's here, I'm going to wear the Blues Brother attire. Though it's relaxing, I don't have as bright of lights in my eyes. I'm kind of enjoying it. It's like a vacation from the TV lights. Paul Joseph Watson joins us here in a moment. Please don't forget that nowhere else are you going to hear somebody like Stefan Molyneux and then Conchita Sarnoff exposing, one of the first people to be exposing the whole Jeffrey Epstein situation, Bill Clinton's pedophile reported island visits. Well, he confirms he went to the pervert island with this guy. We will cover these issues. We will expose it. We will do it. And I can't think of a better place to spend your money, to spend your time spreading the word, to tell folks about InfoWars.com, to send people links to the podcast, the iPhone apps, the free Droid apps, all of it. And to buy the products. I mean, X2 is a game changer. Most people are iodine deficient, or the iodine in the food is bound. You're not absorbing it. Ours is totally pure. You actually absorb it. Things like our methylcobalamin, that's the highest quality organic, absorbable in your mouth, so you actually absorb it. Most people can't absorb it in their gut. You get like 3% of it. That's there. Anthroplex is back in stock. Our vitamin mineral fusion, great bestseller. The first run sold out in a week and a half. It's back. We set out to make the most powerful, full-spectrum vitamin, mineral, and amino acid system. You just put a little bit in a cup of water, stir it up, fruit punch, natural flavored, totally delicious, organic, InfoWarsLife.com. We've also got the storable food. We can't offer 40% off or 30% off as we were doing on everything, but the top four bestsellers, that's going until this Sunday. So if you haven't gotten storable food in these uncertain times, they want you dependent. Don't worry about it anymore. Get the high-quality, easily storable, super, you know, delicious, storable food. It's insurance. You can eat. It's a win-win. You support the broadcast. You've got that out of the way. You're providing for your family. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsSelect.com takes you right to the sub page where you can find the massive, massive discounts on the four bestsellers. What is it? The 4 week, the 3 month, 6 month, and the year. And you can get My Patriot Supply. It's the exact same private labeled stuff. We just get around some loopholes there and are able to offer even more because we private label it. The full spectrum of My Patriot Supply, the folks that private package this for us, is also available, and it's still a great deal as well at InfoWarsStore.com. In fact, if you'd like to support the broadcast more, get your food, just spend a little bit more and get to My Patriot there at InfoWarsStore.com. Also, nutraceutical-wise, not just our 18 products at InfoWarsLife.com we've rolled out in the last 4 years, but also we have InfoWarsHealth.com, and that's the 400-plus products from the great folks at Longevity. You can get the biggest discounts they offer anywhere. In fact, you don't have to join to get the members special. They said, look, you don't have to join Alex to get the member special. Quit saying that. You're wrong. I thought, oh, so you don't pay $30 and get the non-retail? They go, no, you can just buy their retail. You sign up, you get an even bigger discount or free shipping when you sign up for auto ship at InfoWarsHealth.com or InfoWarsTeam.com. Now, that said, drum roll, please. From Her Britannic Majesty's Island Fortress, Peer of the Realm, Paul Joseph Watson, social justice warrior's nemesis complete. Paul, did you realize that they've arrested that guy for the Hitler dog making fun of Hitler? Next, they're going to dig up, exhume Charlie Chaplin, and John Cleese is still alive, but he should be arrested. I agree with you. But did you know that I had 4 years ago done Hitler dog, and I'm actually waiting
for the SWAT teams any moment, like Darth Vader, to blow the doors off the hinges and come in here rightfully and take me to prison. Because have you seen Hitler Dog? It's on Infowars.com, Paul.
Well, I've seen it, and you know it's hilarious. Like this video that this other individual made was hilarious, but we don't have the same rights as, you know, ISIS supporters who can walk around Westminster draped in ISIS flags chanting Allah Akbar. But some people have more equal rights than others. So if you make a joke video about a Nazi dog, and if you go and watch the full video, it's hilarious. And it got 1.1 million views. The vast majority of people loved it. The thumbs up were through the roof. And then, of course, what happened was the social justice warriors, the minority of perpetually offended morons, started the controversy via this mob outrage, which they always do. And for about 2 weeks, it was in the news. It was reported that this video was offensive, but he wasn't actually arrested by the police until a few days ago. So this was escalated. They actually took time to look at it, and they went and arrested him, charged him with hate crimes.
Well, I hope they arrest the dog, too. It's obviously a Nazi. Look, right there's the proof.
that's a cute thing, isn't it? Anyone who watched this video could see that it wasn't even malicious in any way. He made it to annoy his girlfriend. He had a little YouTube channel with like 8 subscribers before this. You know, he's actually a left-wing communist. He's got hammer and sickle tattoos. He's not some Nazi white supremacist.
Well, I wonder if he loves his leftist garbage now. Paul, I'm going to turn the baton over to you. Great job from your Britannic Majesty's eagle's nest. Take care.
Okay, thanks, Alex. Yeah, just to round up on that, we're not going to play the video again. We played it earlier. It's on my channel at YouTube if you want to get it and share it out, if you actually care about free speech, because I mean what I said in the video. I mean, it's getting to the point where I will not be able to do my job anymore and remain in the United Kingdom. Because if that is hate speech, which is what Scottish police are saying now constitutes hate speech, then my entire channel is hate speech. So, I mean, this is the state of free speech in Britain. You know, we've got politicians who read out Winston Churchill quotes in public about what he said about Islam, you know, 60, 70 years ago. They get arrested for a breach of the peace. But, you know, you can have radical Islamic preachers talking about how they want to execute homosexuals all day long. It's perfectly fine. They're given primetime spots on the BBC to do that. As I said, people walking around Westminster in draped in ISIS flags, the police briefly talk to them for a couple of minutes and allow them to go on their way. But God forbid anyone would make a joke video about their dog, Sieg Heiling. Completely ridiculous. Again, he was arrested and charged with hate crimes. And it's not the first time that we've seen this from Scottish police. I don't know what it is with the police in Scotland, but they seem to be the worst for this. As I said in the video, they actually threatened a few weeks ago, it was actually on April the 1st, to go out and perform home visits to anyone who made, quote, hurtful or inaccurate tweets. And everyone was like, oh, this is so ridiculous. It's so off the charts. It's obviously got to be an April Fool's joke, right? No, it wasn't. They didn't delete the tweet. They didn't come back and say, yes, you're right, it was an April Fool's joke. That was a serious tweet. They actually threatened to home visit people for inaccurate tweets. And in fact, that mirrors a story out of China today. That reminds me. This is out of the Global Times. China to launch platform to fight online rumors. China plans to launch a national whistleblower platform Thursday to crack down on online rumors, a measure to further manage cyberspace. Sina Weibo, this is the Chinese version of Twitter, says that users' accounts will be suspended if they are found spreading rumors. And you know that by spreading rumors, they mean criticizing the government. The communist Chinese government shuts down entire areas of the internet when there's civil unrest in certain areas. That's what Joe Lieberman wanted to see introduced in the US back in 2008 through cybersecurity bills. So now they say that in China, the police will, quote, handle these cases in accordance with laws and regulations. So they're talking about people who spread rumors on social media, i.e. criticize the government, are going to get home visits by the police. Exactly the same thing that we now see in the United Kingdom. We are now aping the communist Chinese draconian internet police state, the Great Firewall of China, in threatening home visits for people who make politically incorrect YouTube videos, which of course brings us full circle to the very reason that political correctness was created in communist countries in the first place, which was to censor and stifle dissent made by people who were critical of the state. The only thing that's changed now is it's people who are critical of the prevailing PC culture. You know, the if you don't worship the gracious, culturally enriching Muslims, then you're a hate criminal. Somebody actually reported me to the police back a few months ago for making a video saying that basically stoning women to death for being raped is a bad thing. You know, killing people who leave the religion of Islam is a bad thing. That, according to that individual, that viewer, was hate speech. I was reported to the police. Thankfully, in that case, they didn't follow it up. And this is all being selectively enforced to chill free speech, to make people petrified of expressing their opinion in the first place. We'll be back on the Alex Jones Show Live, 4th Hour Overdrive. Don't go away. We are back at 4th Hour Overdrive of the Alex Jones Show. A few more stories to hit here. We're going to play the rest of the exclusive Billy Corgan interview, so be sure to stay tuned for that. But here's an interesting story. Media covering up Muslim migrant background of Munich knife attacker. Of course, we had this incident yesterday at a train station near the German city of Munich. Several people injured, one dead. The attacker reportedly, the first report said that he chanted Allah Akbar during the rampage. Of course, that was what Manchester police had to apologize for saying. They incorporated that chant into their terror drill yesterday. Of course, that never happens. The vast array of Buddhist Christian suicide bombers make that not a likelihood that that would ever be chanted, but it was apparently chanted in Munich yesterday. And it seemed to be emerging that this was an Islamist motive, that Germany was finally starting to reap the whirlwind of importing 1.1 million Muslim migrants over the past year. And that narrative quickly changed. It was then reported that the assailant was in fact a mentally ill person with a drug problem who was not a Muslim migrant, who was in fact an individual named Paul H, who was a German citizen. Well, now that narrative is being contradicted by German blogger Von Marco Delgado, who asserts that the Paul H explanation is a cover-up and that the attacker's real name is Rafik Youssef. Now, other people are saying that this Youssef character was actually killed by police back in September 2015, so we're still trying to confirm the full details of this. But this blogger said that he spoke to police sources who said that this Paul H individual that was being named in media reports was not a name that was on their list. The police had not identified an individual by that name as being the attacker. And in fact, they said that the explanation that this knife man was in fact a Muslim migrant was still very much open. So we saw immediately after the Paris attacks, as we reported at the time, because we had that incident during the, or just before the Germany-Netherlands soccer game, where they cancelled the game, evacuated everybody from the stadium because of a supposed bomb threat. Immediately afterwards, the German government came out and said, no, nothing happened. There was no bomb threat whatsoever. But then it came out in German media that a paramedic and police officers actually witnessed the explosives inside this fake ambulance and were, quote, told not to talk about it. So the German authorities have previous, when it comes to covering up terror attacks, to hide the fact that the assailant, the attacker, is in fact one of the Muslim migrants that they've been importing for the past year. Again, Cologne police on New Year's Eve, the night of the mass molestation, were told to cover it up. And it was confirmed, in fact, a couple of weeks ago that they were even ordered to remove the word rape from their initial report. We've had other reports where police have been ordered to clamp down to hide details of Muslim migrants being involved in rapes so as not to, quote, legitimize critics of mass migration. We have Germany's top broadcaster, ZDF, refusing to run crime stories about Muslim rape suspects because, in the words of their editor-in-chief, they don't want to inflame the situation and spread the bad mood that migrants don't deserve it. So in every other previous case in Germany, we've seen a deliberate attempt to cover up these rapes, these attempted terror attacks, again, to defend that narrative that Germany is under threat from these waves of, in many cases, radicals that are coming into the country. And we could have seen that once again with the attack in Munich yesterday. Alex mentioned it. We're going to go to the clip now. Here's Vicente Fox, the former Mexican president, saying that Mexico could go to war with the United States over Donald Trump's offensive comments. Here's the clip.
In this words and messages of hate, what's going to happen in the Middle East? We're coming back to the era of the ugly American, which was the gringo was hated all around the world. Yeah. And this guy, pretty soon he got the title now.
Yeah.
He is the ugly American. He is the hated gringo because he's attacking all of us. He's offending all of us. Imagine, that could take us to a war, not to a trade war.
Oh,
it
you
could
think
take
so?
Us, oh, of course. I mean, I can tell you in Mexico, we have a saying. We say, okay, we are chiquitos.
Yeah.
We're small, but we're picosos.
Yeah.
We're like the jalapeno. So don't play around with us. Don't play around with us. We can jump walls. We can swim rivers. And we can defend ourselves.
So there's the former president of Mexico. And these comments were not really picked up by the media. They glossed over it and focused on him using the word gringo to describe Trump. Actually, not only warning, you could say threatening an actual conflict, a war with the United States, all over Donald Trump's offensive rhetoric. How ludicrous is that, that Fox would go to that level of hyperbole simply to denounce Donald Trump? We'll be back on the Alex Jones Show live after the breaks. We are back. It's the Alex Jones Show live. And it has been announced that German Chancellor Angela Merkel will attend this year's secretive Bilderberg Group conference, along with several top heads within the German federal government. Again, emphasizing the importance of this annual confab. And of course, her attendance has united both left and right in Germany, who are decrying this, saying that she will be at the mercy of lobbyists. And of course, as per usual, InfoWars will be in attendance in Dresden, Germany. Our reporters will be on the ground at great expense, as it always is, the streaming, the travel, the equipment, which is why it's important for you to get the products and supporters by visiting InfoWarsStore.com. We got 30 to 40% off our best-selling storable food, the four-week supply, the three-month supply, the six-month and the one-year supply. Astounding discount right now at InfoWarsStore.com, 30 to 40% off. And Vitamin Mineral Fusion is back in stock, but only for a limited time. So again, it's vital for you to support us, to enable us to send reporters to these key globalist summits to try and squeeze out some information, as difficult as it is. But it's really important that we're on the ground. And of course, we need your backing to do so. We wouldn't be able to be there without it. So please get the products at InfoWarsStore.com. Now we're going to finish off this exclusive Billy Corgan interview, laying the smackdown on the social justice warriors. Here's the remainder of that interview.
I'm the type of person, I saw that report, I was fascinated by it. I actually went to the woman's Twitter account and I read a bunch of her tweets, because as somebody in public life, I know not to just take your word for it. I wanted to see for myself, what is the messaging, what is the perspective? Maybe she said one dumb thing and she said 10 things that were really wise. I want to learn. So you can, if you can bring that into a wider frame, I think that's very, very helpful to people, to encourage investigation and not just take it. Because at the end of the day, if this is propaganda one and they say you're just propaganda two, then it's always going to be an argument, who's got the moral high ground?
Right, and we definitely see that in the comment section, that people are like, oh, well, this is that and this, you know.
Leanne, you're a privileged white woman. You have no right to say that.
Right.
So by engaging in the wider topic of free speech, libertarianism, supporting values which you don't agree with, but at the same time sort of calling it for what it is, you know, you can engage without having to shut it down.
Right now we have like a whole movement in the youth. These people truly feel this is their civil rights movement of their time, and they feel like they're on the right. And so if you, for instance, if it's a Trump, anti-Trump rally, they think that people on the Trump side are just racist, homophobic, xenophobic, shut it down. I don't want to hear anything you say because I'm on the right side of history here and I don't even need to hear your facts. And so how do you kind of educate these people that possibly their ideas aren't authentically individual?
My argument is you can't. They're too far gone. And that may sound pessimistic because I know that you want a solution-based concept. I think when somebody reaches the point where they literally cannot see a human being on the other side of the argument, and I'm not even talking about religion, okay? I'm talking about humanism. The law, as it's constructed in Western civilization, is based on the idea that a human has a sort of sovereign right to exist. Of course, people argue about when that life begins. That's a different subject. But the point is this sovereign right has a vote. They have a life, and they have a right to live it, pursuit of, and then we obviously have a different idea in America. So when somebody has reached the point where they literally do not see that person as a voice, a vote, and they have a story, and they have a family. Look, I've said it before. I grew up around a lot of racists in my family. Would I call them bad people? No. Would I call them misinformed? Yeah. Was that due to experience? Do they have a right to their belief? They would argue that they had a right to their belief because something happened in 1984 and they had some guy from a different race say something and they were never going to listen to that race again and anything to do. Okay, that's racist as I would define it. When you reach a point where that person cannot even respect that person across them's path to arrive at a particular point, then what's the discussion about? You have no right. So you're talking about disenfranchising. There's no discussion. Their tactics in the social justice warrior movement are to stifle and shut down free speech. And I would argue in the world of that I live in, which is the bare knuckle world, they're leveraging their position because they don't have power. Now, of course, their argument is they've been systemically disenfranchised by systems, right? Pick your poison on that. They might even have an argument, okay? But at the end of the day, if you don't recognize the leverage that they're using, you ultimately come back to the same conclusion, which is they don't have power because they are not on the moral high ground. The moral high ground would be, I want to engage you because ultimately I believe that my argument will win over your argument, or I will place something in your heart like the mustard seed like Jesus talked about that will grow and make you realize the error of your ways. That is not what this is about. It is to shut you down, to leverage a minority position, and I'm not using the word minority in a racial pejorative way. I'm talking about groups that statistically don't have leverage to just vote their way through.
How do we kind of see through that, knowing like, okay, this is kind of an evolutionary step that we as humans need to take versus, okay, now I'm being told that this is what I'm being conditioned to accept. Socialism.
I think if you're curious, you have to start by separating the truth. I think admitting to yourself your own truth is always a good place to start. Like when I watch some of the clips that you guys have been putting up at some of these protests, I have no respect for what these people are doing. I don't. They're shutting down free speech. They're shutting down processes that I just don't get it. To me, it's antithetical to the society that I believe in. And as I said on Alex's show, they're eventually going to come after me. It's just the way history works, okay? But, I try to listen to their argument. And where I do recognize the argument as having merit, I try to consider it, and then I try to think into terms of practical application. In essence, don't become them. Mm. Don't shut your ears, okay? Try to understand the forces at play. It's hard to tell someone who feels disenfranchised by the system or the government or whatever the world they live in. You try to tell someone here who you might argue is taking advantage of our social welfare system or gaming the system somehow and say, look, you have it, and you're telling me America sucks and you're spitting on the flag. Try go living in one of these third world countries and see how far that gets you. It's always very interesting to me, and this is a very prickly point to make. It's very interesting to me when you see the way gays and lesbians are treated in some other countries in the world. If they have that level of vitriol for, let's say, Donald Trump as a candidate, because they feel it's antithetical to what they believe in, where's the five times greater condemnation for those societies that mm-hmm. are treating their people far worse right. than just words and ideas? I mean, it's always interesting to me that how people kind of pick their spots. Mm-hmm. That always rings it's like a red flag for me. Mm-hmm. That means they're really not in it at the real level.
Right.
And then you start realizing, look, most people are trendy. Right? Most people are trendy. For every 5 hardcore people that are there, they're spitting in your face. There's 50 people there just doing the...
They just want to be a part of the scene.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, racist. You know, it's like they wouldn't even know what it means.
What do you think about that, that we have people wanting to take away what makes this country so great and gives them the right and the freedom to go out there and say whatever they want, and they want to now chip away at free speech, trying to say, well, it's offensive, and so should offensive speech, should you be allowed to do it? You know, not everyone's offended by speech, so how do you...
That's a fantastic question, and I'm going to say something that I think is probably the most important thing to me in everything that we're talking about. We all remember the cartoon, you know, Bugs Bunny and Yosemite Sam or whatever, and draws the line. You don't step over that line, he steps over the line, and he draws another line, and right? Okay. For me, personally, we're at the last line. Free speech is the last line. So, if you're saying to me, look, what's more important, identifying with social movements that do have valid and real concerns as they see it from their own perspective and community. In essence, their voice does need to be heard and respected, even if at the end of the day you don't agree. Okay, if that can be done while maintaining free speech, in essence, we're kind of a rolling Linus ball of dust and we're just moving forward as civilizations do, great. I'm more than happy to have that discussion. I'm more than happy to have that discussion with politicos, people in the entertainment business, social justice warriors. And I've had these discussions through the years with, I mean, when I talked about God in the 90s in my songs, you know, the right-wing preachers came at me. I was, one of my proudest moments was I was picketed in the last year by the
Westboro?
Yeah. I was like, wow, badge of honor. This is awesome. You know what I mean? I'm actually still dangerous, right?
Yeah.
Okay. To me, and I hope this makes sense because I'm rambling a bit, but... The free speech line, without free speech, none of those arguments matter.
Right.
Not a one. Because once we lose that, there's no end. And I'm sorry if you're a student in history, and I've read plenty of books, you name it. If you've ever seen The Killing Fields about Pol Pot and, you know, the Khmer Rouge, you know, what Stalin did, you know, obviously what Hitler did, any socialist system, which tend to be left, by the way, just a little point in there. Once you cross that line, okay, you look at every totalitarian regime in the last 100-something years, who did they kill first? They killed the disabled. And who do they kill next? They kill the artists. Okay? Why are ideas, as John Lennon once sang, imagine, da-da-da, why are ideas so powerful? Because they are. They are the thing that cannot be defended against. An idea, a whisper, a rumor cannot be, no wall can stop the truth, right? So no matter what side you're on, left, right, libertarian, you lose the free speech lane, it's over. Because we all lose. Mm. Every one of us. And I don't care who you are, where you come from, where you're at on the wheel. Okay, which does explain sort of in the greater zeitgeist of the idea, why the mega wealthy and the elites are preparing to go off grid, off planet, buying lots of land in Costa Rica or BC and all that stuff, because they got the quarterback read and they see when that fur goes, it's gonna fly.
Yeah.
We don't want to get there. That's my point. Once we lose that lane of free speech in this country, it's over. It might still be called America, but it is over. Mm-hmm. So I don't care what your trendy argument, I don't care what your hashtag argument is. If you do not stand for free speech, you do not stand for America. That means you want something else. And if you think your something else is going to be better than America, I'm here to tell you, you're wrong. And I will fight that fight to my dying breath. Because look, I was propagandized as a kid to believe that everything America did was great. And like a lot of people, as I got into the world in the 70s and 80s, I realized that wasn't true. America has done plenty of horrible things. Start with the Native Americans and work your way backwards. So I'm no, you know, America's perfect, you know. I've never believed that, nor did my father. But I do believe America's better than any other political and social system that's ever been created in the world. Prove me wrong, I'm willing to listen. But we're Americans, we love our country, and if you're a true American, you even love the enemy.
Right.
So we can cry and laugh and shake our heads at the social justice warriors. True Americans and libertarians want them in that system. Let's have that argument.
Well, and on that note, so with the social media is kind of the engine where a lot of these social justice movements is kind of gaining momentum, but it's also where they're being sort of corralled and controlled as well. So they can take your free speech and hide that line of code so it never trends, or the algorithms will just shut down and you won't be able to reach your audience. And so talk to people a little bit about how to use these systems for good, or to use, you know, vote with your dollars or your feet, so to speak, to not allow them to start controlling us, because they truly are.
A lot of my friends are what I would quantify as average American citizens, my family. What do they do at a participatory level to either encourage or discourage things that they don't agree with? And I think it takes a little bit more savvy, if we're in the info war, it takes a little bit more savvy to know how to get into those systems in a way that we can leverage our own position, just like the social justice warriors do. But at the same time, not resort to the kind of the scummy part of it all, which is sort of leading people astray. Look, when you use the word liberty, most people don't find that word sexy. You know, racist has a lot more ooh-ah to it than libertarian. Libertarian sounds like you're stuck in the back of a truck with Ron Paul and he's talking to you about, like, you know,
freedom.
Policy papers and freedom. It doesn't sound very exciting to me, okay? You know, I tend to like the social argument. You have to start, this would be my argument, you have to start by identifying that the most powerful thing in the world right now are these technocratic systems that are in place, search engines, the way we connect on these social platforms. Governments have either encouraged these things to come along or quickly realizes that they were the new element, arms of control. And so you have to ask yourself whether your participation in these systems is actually enslaving you. Then you have to drill down a little further and you have to want to ask questions about if what you're doing and participating in is truly as open as it seems. So if Twitter, for example, is full of people of a diverse set of opinions and you feel like, hey, it's capitalist, it's my idea versus yours, who tweets more, who gets more retweets, who says the right incendiary thing, who does the right meme, great. That's America, great. And I would only argue, you know, where do you cross the line? And you see it all the time. I mean, InfoWars puts up articles. As somebody who's in the world, and I have to watch what I say, when you see a page that's literally, and the Facebook page is assassinate Donald Trump, and I believe Facebook comes out and says that doesn't violate our standards and practices.
Yeah.
Okay, that's where somebody like myself has to ask, is my participation in the Facebook system, and I would call it a system, am I actually encouraging something which as an American I find offensive?
Mm-hmm.
And I also find it offensive that a business would support, you can call, I would have no problem with a page that said, Donald Trump's a racist, Donald Trump's a homophobe, because that's just opinion. The minute you talk about killing someone, sorry, that's where you need to step in as a business, say, I will not support that. So why is that okay? But you can imagine what page you could create on Facebook today, and there would be calls for you to never work here at InfoWars ever again.
Right.
That's where it gets funky. So you have to be sophisticated enough to look at those systems and say, is my participation encouraging something that I know deep down is intrinsically not only flawed, but counterintuitive to what I want to be part of?
Mm-hmm.
And in essence, your participation is condonement. Now, I run a business. I have a Facebook page. I need the Facebook page at this day to run my business. It's an effective system. I don't like everything. So that's just another piece of information that may ultimately push me off Facebook. And I'm willing to take the commercial and public hit of not having that reach that I have to the 4 million plus people that follow us on Facebook, because at the end of the day, I as an American can't support that. So does it bother me? Yes. Do I have to have the argument in my head? Yes. To this point, I haven't made that decision. If you're not having that argument in your own head, then you're not participating. And then, to use Alex's term, you're just a drone who's just following around. You're pretending you have no influence, and you do.
Mm. And I think, too, it's really time for a lot of us who are libertarians and who are for freedom and who are concerned and who do, we're not kind of in the trance. We do need to start coming together and working and setting up our own systems to counteract their systems right. that they have.
That's why I would use the word empowerment. Empowering people with, let's not call it the facts and the truth. The facts and truth are always kind of ephemeral, this eye of the beholder stuff. Empowering people to have a better range of decision-making as far as how they approach their social systems, I think that's powerful. Then if you take the extra step and you say, like maybe InfoWars sets up its own version of social media so that like-minded businesses are able to participate in a system that is ultimately holistic mm-hmm. to the ideas that you would believe in.
Yeah, some open source social media networks as well.
I think those days are coming soon.
Yeah.
And trust me, if 20% of people suddenly jumped off Facebook, they would notice.
Yeah.
They look at those numbers every day. Just right. like I would notice if suddenly there were 20% empty seats.
Well, it's like you have these huge groups, like the Soros-backed groups there, that they've all joined together now, all these little minority movements. They've all decided to come together, and now they are of a smaller majority
but the
movement.
Beauty of,
and so people are, you know, you got to understand what you're up against with
you know,
these
again,
machines.
From a capitalist free market position, I don't have any problem with that. If seven independent hot dog stands band together to form a hot dog association because they need to leverage their position in the market, great. They should have the right to do that. The thing you know, though, and you know it, and you can know it in your heart, and I'm going to say it right to the camera, they will all turn on each other. The left always eats its own. Mm. And the minute they gain what they want, they'll turn on each other because they're rapacious and they can't help themselves. Yeah. They have to have a cause. Their identity is born of the cause. There was a great article that came out when the gay marriage, the Supreme Court, all that stuff. Okay, gay marriage is now part of law of the land. Okay, there were articles about people being depressed because the movement was over. They'd won.
Yeah.
You know, if that was your argument and you wanted it and you got it, great. That's an incredible victory if that's the side you're on. And having grown up and watched people die of AIDS and being part of that in my own particular way, I thought, good, great. You got what you wanted. Got to go on to the next thing because it was about the identity of waving that particular flag. The victory was not in the thing. The victory was in the march.
Yeah, being a part of that big movement.
So understand a lot of these trendies, the minute the thing gets boring or it gets too hard or it breaks down into policy, social movements are easy to begin. You know, you're being disenfranchised. Yeah, your vote counts. Yeah. When you get into the level of policy and regulation and sitting like I have at the local civic board meeting for 4 hours and they're talking about water mains, that's where most people, that's where the trendy stuff stops. Yeah, they'll tap out and or they'll turn on each other. So at least in your own heart, when you watch them abusing InfoWars reporters, no, they can't, look in 20 years and see where they're at. They won't be still twizzling the New Year's toy, guarantee you.
Right, yeah, well, that's why a lot of people point out how, for instance, Bernie Sanders isn't really reaching a lot of people that are 30 and up. Or even 40 and up, because it's a lot of just young people that don't necessarily have the experience.
46% of Americans don't pay any form of tax, at least in terms of federal or state. Of course. Free stuff, great. Give me more free stuff.
Yeah.
Sounds good. That sounds good to me.
No freedom.
That's why I'm for Bernie. I want more free stuff.
Yeah, exactly. Well, Billy, thank you so much for joining us in studio. This is kind of the first of a series of social, cultural breakdown we're going to be doing.
It's the beginning of your own personal revolution.
Yes, indeed. Our individual, true individual ideas. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.